Mali in decades, and anti-regime protests were prohibited by law. Many of those who turned out were deeply worried about what would happen. With tanks and soldiers standing by, some feared police might open fire. Keep in mind, the deadly protests in Beijing's Tiananmen Square had taken place just 6 months earlier in March 1989. Shockingly, though, the East German leadership chose not to act. The protest was allowed to proceed with crowds streaming through the center of town past the regional office of the country's secret police, the Stasi. For many, this was seen as the beginning of the end of East Germany. A month later, on November 4th, 1989, a half million people marched into East Berlin's main square, the Alexanderplatz. It was the largest demonstration in the oppressive state's history and was the catalyst for its demise just 4 days later. On November 8, 1989, as political pressure built in East Germany, the spokesman for East Berlin's Communist Party, Günter Schabowski, headed to a media briefing with reporters. What happened next immediately brought down the once formidable Berlin Wall. But the funny thing is, it was kind of an accident. Let me explain. The media briefing was carried live on TV, and if you watch the footage now, you can see most of the reporters look a little bit bored. They weren't expecting the bombshell that was to come.
Also, Privatreisen nach dem Ausland können ohne Vorliegen von Voraussetzungen Reise.
Schabowski begins reading a prepared statement and casually announces that the government has decided to introduce a bill which will allow every citizen to travel out of East Germany by way of border crossing points. With those words, a reporter snaps back to attention and he asks, when does this come into force? Schabowski was clearly caught off guard. He doesn't know when. He flips through his papers, he looks through his reading glasses, and then he says,
das tritt nach meiner Kenntnis ist das sofort, unverzüglich.
As far as I'm aware, immediately, straight away. The thing is, he was wrong. It wasn't immediately. It was supposed to be the next day. Police and border guards knew nothing of the changes. But remember, the news conference was being carried live on TV, and news of the announcement spread quickly. So East and West Berliners flocked to the wall, drinking beer and champagne and chanting Tor Oath, open the gates. Finally, at midnight on November 9th, 1989, guards threw open the gates. And East Berliners began pouring across the border. They came by foot and by car. A column of tiny two-cylinder East German cars rolled into the west. The scene was jubilant. People cried and cheered as they entered West Germany, either for the first time ever or the first time in 28 years. They were met on the other side by West Germans who greeted them with flowers and champagne. Strangers hugged and kissed. Then together, East and West Berliners climbed on top of the Berlin Wall in front of the Brandenburg Gate to dance and to celebrate. While chanting, the wall is gone, people used hammers and picks to knock away chunks of the wall. That weekend, more than 2 million East Berliners streamed into West Berlin through the iconic Checkpoint Charlie. It's probably the most well-known Cold War border crossing, which served for 28 years as the only spot where foreigners could enter the Soviet-controlled East Berlin. But now it served as a gateway to a massive celebration that was described by at least one journalist as the greatest street party in the history of the world. On their way through the checkpoint, each East Berliner was given 100 West German marks as a welcome gift.
They poured across the border on foot, in cars, or on packed subways.
I'm just amazed that it came so soon. I mean, it's incredible.
This morning, authorities at crossing points were rendered virtually helpless by the size of the crowd still streaming across. Some came west to stay. Others came just to look around for a couple of hours before going back to their homes in East Berlin. Officials say the wall itself will remain standing for military security, but it's now little more than a symbol. At one point this morning, some civilians offered flowers to East German border guards. In the past, they would have been shot for such a gesture, or at least imprisoned.
On Saturday afternoon, 2 days after the border was opened, an impromptu free concert was held to celebrate. Joe Cocker, Melissa Etheridge, and Canadian musician Andrew Cash joined 16 German pop groups at Deutschland Hall. Cash was on tour promoting his second solo album as the opening act for Etheridge. And halfway through their European tour, fate brought them to Berlin the very night that the wall was opened.
Me and one of my bandmates immediately went, headed to Checkpoint Charlie, which is, I think we heard that that was where a lot of East Berliners were coming through. And I don't remember the bar, but there was a bar situated conveniently right at the checkpoint. And we went in there, and we went in there at probably about 2 p.m. and ended up getting out of there at about 2 a.m. It was an incredible scene in there. Just people walk in through the checkpoint and head into the bar. That was their first time into West Berlin, some of them since they were children. And you know, they'd be many times just people just come up and hug me, right? You know, and just, I mean, we had just arrived there ourselves, right? But people were just so overwhelmed. It was incredible.
Cash said taking part in the impromptu concert was an equally moving experience. He sang his signature song, Time and Place, which was a perfect addition to the show. It's a song about holding out for something better, about having hope for the future. Cash, who left music for politics in 2011 when he became an NDP MP for a Toronto area riding, says that weekend was one of the most remarkable of his life. The fall of the wall and then the release of Nelson Mandela in 1990 taught him something very important.
These events certainly reaffirmed my commitment and understanding of how change happens. It happens gradually, but it happens as a result of a million different factors and people being faithful and resilient and never stopping the tide of, of social justice and freedom.
The tide of freedom in Germany continued to swell over the next few weeks. Refugees poured into West Germany at a rate of 2,000 a day. Emergency shelters were overflowing with tens of thousands of East Germans who wanted to make a new home in the West. During the Cold War, life on either side of the wall was very different. West Germany was thriving economically, and West Berlin was no exception. Theaters, zoos, museums, shops, and nightclubs all lined the main streets of West Berlin. In East Germany, on the other hand, the economy was depressed by the loss of so many educated professionals. Most buildings were drab, gray, and nearly identical to each other. Citizens could afford very few luxuries, and even if they could, food and other consumer items were extremely scarce. For example, in the winter, East Germans might be able to buy a single kilo of bananas or oranges. That's it, 1 kilo for the whole winter. And if they wanted to buy a car, there was at least a 10-year waiting list. The car they would get was a 2-cylinder Trabant. The Trabi was built in East Germany and possessed roughly the same horsepower as a go-kart. For some, well, the little Trabi symbolized everything that was wrong with communism. But the economic and aesthetic conditions weren't the worst problems. It was the atmosphere of fear that drove so many East Germans to flee. No one could be certain who was a member or an informant for the Stasi, the dreaded secret police. People were regularly taken in for questioning and often jailed for speaking out against the government, or even if a neighbor simply claimed that they had spoken out. So it's no surprise that once the border was open, East Germans flocked to the other side, even just to take a look. To handle the flow, 48 hours after the wall opened, 10 new crossing points were added. The East German government also formally abolished the death strip, where would-be escapers had once been shot by border guards. Those border guards were now given the job of removing the rolls of barbed wire that lined the infamous section of the wall. When the party was over, politicians began the difficult task of figuring out the future for the two Germanys. Trying to figure out how in the world you merge a generation of capitalism with a generation of socialism. By the end of the month, a mere 20 days after the border had been flung open, West German Chancellor Helmut Kohl answered the question. He proposed a 10-step plan to slowly bring the two countries closer together, eventually leading to a new united Germany. The majority of West Germans were on board with the plan, but Allied countries were a bit fearful of a unified Germany. Those World War II wounds were still fresh for some. Chancellor Kohl tried to put those fears to rest by promising that a single Germany would never be a threat again. Instead, it would help unite all of Europe. As for East Germany, well, the leaders there said reunification wasn't even on the table. But they said they'd be happy to discuss closer cooperation with the West. Some East German citizens were also leery, because with communism also came an extensive benefit system they didn't necessarily want to lose completely. For example, rent in West Germany for a basic one-bedroom apartment in 1990 was about $700 to $900 a month. In East Germany, the same apartment would cost about $10 a month. Political chaos in the East continued for weeks after the wall came down. In Dresden one night, a junior Soviet officer was working at the local KGB headquarters when the building was swarmed by protesters. He called the headquarters of a Red Army tank unit to ask for protection, but he was told they couldn't do anything without orders from Moscow. And Moscow was silent, so the Red Army tanks would not be used for protection. The young officer and his KGB colleagues took matters into their own hands. They frantically burned evidence of their intelligence work. The protesters eventually backed down, but the experience taught the officer lessons he has never forgotten to this day. It gave him ideas for a model society and shaped his ambitions for a powerful network and personal wealth. Who was that junior officer? Well, it was none other than Vladimir Putin. The tides of change continued sweeping through Germany. Then on December 23rd, just 6 weeks after the border was first thrown open, another major milestone. For the first time in 28 years, the Brandenburg Gate, the supreme symbol of Berlin, was reopened. The neoclassical gate was built in 1791 as one of 13 city gates, and it was the crowning ornament at the end of the boulevard that ran from the Kaiser's palace. But since the building of the Berlin Wall, neither East nor West Berliners had access to it. The night before the gate was reopened, a crowd of people gathered to watch as massive sections of concrete were taken away by crane to make two new crossing points. The next day, tens of thousands of jubilant Berliners stood in the pouring rain and cheered as the gate was officially opened as a pedestrian crossing. But all this celebrating was starting to take its toll. By early 1990, West Berlin was littered with garbage. Roads were jammed as the population would often double on the weekends with visiting East Berliners. And there was the constant sound of chipping and clanging as people used pickaxes and hammers to take away bits of the Berlin Wall. There were human-sized holes in the wall, like crude doors, and people could step in and out of them, crossing back and forth with ease from east to west. But soon it became a safety issue. People had chopped away so many sections that parts of the wall were in danger of collapsing. East German border guards welded steel bars over gaping holes to shore up the wall. Sadly, a slab of the wall did tip over, and a 14-year-old boy was crushed as he was chipping away at it. A short time later, work crews with heavy equipment finally began tearing down the remainder of the wall. With the wall down, change moved fast through East Germany in 1990. By March, East Germans voted in their first free election in over 50 years. And they came out in droves, with 93% of the country's 12 million people casting ballots in what was essentially a referendum on reunification. The choices were stick with the Communist Party, which wanted cooperation with the West but not reunification, or vote for a conservative alliance of three parties who supported reunification. The result was overwhelmingly in favor of the conservative alliance and reunification with the West, essentially spelling an end to the East German state. It was the final victory for the peaceful revolution. By May 1990, the two Germanys signed a treaty for an economic union, setting them on a path toward a single nation. The treaty formally scrapped East Germany's communist system and created a single German economy. It transferred West Germany's robust currency and its economic, monetary, and social laws to the East as of July 1st. At the same time, all border controls around West Berlin would end. East Germany was transformed from a socialist society to a capitalist society. It was the last and final step before a unified Germany was born. Before we get there, there's somewhere else I want to go. I want to talk about the concert that is ingrained in our memories when we think of the fall of the Berlin Wall. It was a rock tribute to a historical watershed where art took over reality, and it was all led by former Pink Floyd frontman Roger Waters. For one night only on July 21st, No Man's Land between Potsdamer Platz and the Brandenburg Gate became the set for a legendary performance of Pink Floyd's The Wall. The barren land between the two former countries was left abandoned for such a long time that when they decided to clean it up for the concert, they found bombs, grenades, and live gun shells in the area. Hours before the concert was to start, people were jammed in as far as you could see. Nearby rooftops were packed as well. The organizers had sold 160,000 tickets, but the crowds outside got so big that worried organizers took down the fences, allowing 160,000 more people in without tickets. It's estimated that about 350,000 people attended the concert in person, but it was broadcast to more than 500 million people around the world. The stage, which was perpendicular to the Berlin Wall, featured a massive wall made up of 2,500 foam bricks. It was 170 meters long and 25 meters high. From the opening moments when hundreds of toy soldiers hanging from mini parachutes floated to the ground, the crowd was mesmerized. There were military trucks, motorbikes, limousines, and the marching band of the combined Soviet forces in Germany. Roger Waters was joined by a guest list that included musicians like Van Morrison, Sinead O'Connor, Cyndi Lauper, Joni Mitchell, and Bryan Adams. The crowd was swept up. They knew they were experiencing history. The grand finale came when the massive wall came crashing down along with a blinding display of pyrotechnics. After this epic concert in the heart of Berlin, it was back to work for politicians. On August 22, 1990, the East German parliament voted in favor of acceding to West Germany. But before the two countries united, there was one more hurdle they wanted to clear, and it was a big one. A united Germany wanted to be readmitted to NATO. The Soviet Union was initially against the idea, but during last-minute negotiations, changed its mind. The USSR, along with the US, Britain, and France, agreed to reverse the division of Germany and reunite. Germany was allowed to become a full member of NATO with the condition that it never have an army with more than 370,000 soldiers. And they were not allowed to have nuclear weapons. And so the path was completely cleared. On October 30th, 1990, at midnight, East Germany formally joined West Germany and ceased to exist. The celebrations that night were more organized than the impromptu euphoria that took place less than a year earlier when the Berlin Wall was opened. But the event was no less important. Under a bright moon, hundreds of thousands of Germans gathered outside the legislative building and sang the new unified German national anthem. It no longer included a verse which declared Germany above all in the world. Instead, it urged Germany to flourish and called for justice, unity, and peace. Since reunification, Germany has become Europe's most industrialized and populous country. Today, Germany is known as an economic giant. But the economy in the East has never managed to catch up with the West. And recent studies found that half of all Germans believe there are still some pretty big differences between the East and the West, mainly money. People in the East tend to earn half as much as people in the West. Experts say it will take at least another generation before the two parts have truly grown back together. As far as the Berlin Wall goes, well, parts of the wall still stand today in Berlin. Plus, there's a Berlin Wall Memorial, and pieces of the wall have been sent to places around the world. And surprisingly, there are some pieces that have been hidden from view, which have been found in recent years. In June 2018, several locals on a walking tour found a 20-meter section of the crumbling Berlin Wall covered in graffiti. The relic had been covered by overgrown bushes, which is how it had escaped discovery for so long. Thank you for joining me on this look back at the events that led up to one of the most important moments of the 1990s. I'd love to hear from you about what you think about this episode, and also what you think are some important moments from the 90s. Please email me anytime at 90s@curiouscast.ca. I see all your emails and try to answer when I can. That's 90s@curiouscast.ca. You can also reach me through Twitter at 1990s History, and I'm on Instagram and Facebook. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to our show so you never miss an episode. And while you're there, don't forget to rate and review us. We're available for free at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and everywhere else you get your streaming audio. You can also listen at curiouscast.ca. This show was hosted and co-written by me, Kathy Kinzora, and Dila Velazquez, our producer. Sound design and final production is by Rob Johnston. See you next time for more History of the 90s.
Hey, I'm Brett Chang.
And I'm Jay Rosenthal.
And we're here to tell you about Canada's only daily business news podcast.
It's called The Peak Daily, and every morning we get you up to speed on the need-to-know Canadian and global business news stories.
And we do it without all the jargon that can make business news a little dull. Dull, exactly.
And we do it all in less than 10 minutes.
6 minutes if we fast forward through your dad jokes.
But I prefer to call them rad jokes.
Come for the news, stay for the dad jokes. Join us and thousands of Peak Pals every morning to start your day smarter. Find The Peak Daily wherever you listen to your podcasts.
What do girls want? What do they really, really want? In the 1996 song Wannabe by the Spice Girls, they wanted would-be boyfriends to get their act together so they could be just fine. But that one song launched something more, much more.
Girl power, feminism, do you know what I mean?
I'm Kathy Kinzora, and this is the History of the 90s, a podcast where we tell the stories that defined a decade that changed the world. On this episode, we're looking back at the two words that introduced a generation of girls to feminism and empowerment, girl power. Being a teen girl in the 90s was tough, tougher than it had been in previous decades. More and more, girls were falling into drugs, self-harm, and eating disorders as a way to cope with what psychologist Mary Pfeiffer called a girl poisoning culture. In 1994, a book by Pfeiffer called Reviving Ophelia, Saving the Selves of Adolescent Girls, became a best-selling publishing phenomenon, suddenly putting the spotlight on teen girls. It identified the many mixed messages that girls were getting in the 90s. Be beautiful, but beauty is only skin deep. Be sexy, but not sexual. Be honest, but don't hurt anyone's feelings. It argued that girls were giving up their authentic selves to live up to cultural demands of thinness, beauty, and sexuality. Alison Yarrow, author of the book 90s Bitch, Media Culture and the Failed Promise of Gender Equality, says teen girls were bombarded with the perfect girl ideal thanks to the explosion of teen magazines in the 90s. Magazines like Teen Vogue, Seventeen, YM, and Sassy.
This idea of the perfect girl was really just throughout each page. You could see young women who were thin. They were blonde. They were white. They didn't have rolls or a thigh gap. They, you know, they looked perfect, but they didn't look like they had to work for that perfection. So I think a lot of young girls in the 90s saw these images sort of in their magazines and also in the selling of clothing and makeup and sort of anything that was marketed to young women. They saw this perfect girl as the sort of the vector of this, you know, this desire to be perfect.
Yarrow says girls were smart enough to know that the perfect girl wasn't real or achievable, but even still, they couldn't help but try to be her. This pressure led to self-destructive behaviors like self-harm, eating disorders, and even suicide. Self-esteem became a buzzword right around this time. It became the elixir or antidote to what was seen as the girl crisis of the 90s.
So you saw sort of government programs about building self-esteem, and it was definitely sort of lip service given to young girls in elementary school and middle school and high school. You know, if only you had self-esteem, if you can sort of build self-esteem, then you can avoid some of the pitfalls that were associated with the girl crisis of the 90s.
Right around this time, the ultimate self-esteem booster, girl power, rose to prominence. If you're thinking Spice Girls, you're not wrong. And I promise you, we will get to them. But you might not know that the two words best associated with that girl group from the UK was actually born out of the Riot Girl movement. The Riot Girl movement began in the early 90s in and around Olympia, Washington. It was part of the underground feminist punk scene and morphed into a loosely organized network of thousands of women worldwide. Young female musicians gathered for informal meetings to talk and support each other amid a rock scene that was very much a boys' club. A Guardian article in 2009 described it this way. Riot Girl was angry and subversive. It mocked the doe-eyed, perfectly groomed cheerleader aesthetic. It was pierced, tattooed, and wore short skirts. It was loud, unapologetic, and vocal. The Riot Girl movement included bands like Bikini Kill, Bratmobile, and Heavens to Betsy. They wrote slut, rape, and whore on their stomachs at performances and protests. And they hoisted signs that read, "We are not things." They boycotted mainstream record labels and cultural influences. They ate vegetarian diets and avoided alcohol and drugs. Riot Girl developed in part as a reaction to the male-dominated punk scene in the Pacific Northwest. But it grew into so much more.
It was really women artists and, you know, musicians coming together to protest just the various sort of cultural ills being perpetrated on young women. Everything from, you know, harassment and abuse to pay inequity, lack of reproductive choice and access. And so women, you know, sort of allowed for punk music to be the sort of the stage for these protests. So they wrote music and created art to raise awareness about these bigger issues.
Music was simply a way to communicate the message that girlhood was under attack and it needed to be taken back by girls. Riot Girl had no leaders, but the band Bikini Kill was considered the backbone of the movement. The band formed in 1990 in Olympia, Washington, and then relocated to Washington, D.C. They believed that if all girls started bands, the world would change. They actively encouraged women and girls to start bands as a means of cultural resistance. The band was fronted by singer Kathleen Hanna. On stage, between songs, she would talk about the sexual abuse she suffered, rape, and being catcalled on the street by lewd men. After shows, fans would come up to her and tell her about their own similar experiences and how important it was for them to hear another woman talking openly about those things. A phenomenon similar to the hashtag MeToo movement decades later. Hanna was famous for shouting, "Girls to the front," to protect fangirls at their shows from the moshing bodies of men. The band has described their shows back in the 90s as war, with men often going just to shout slurs and insults at them, or to try and enact violence against them. A January 2019 article in NME stated that skinheads would bring chains to their shows and throw them at the band. A quick aside about Hannah, she was friends with Kurt Cobain before Nirvana, and legend has it that she wrote Kurt Smells Like Teen Spirit on his bedroom wall, inspiring Nirvana's biggest hit. As for the term girl power, Hannah told Vice in 2016 she first used it in the early 1990s as the name of the band's fanzine. She and drummer Toby Gale were trying to invoke the strength of the Black Power slogan from the 60s and the 70s. Fanzines were DIY fan magazines that were photocopied and shared by a network of girls across the country. The girls wrote them, produced them, and distributed them on their own. If you're not familiar with zines, I guess you could say they were kind of like the original blogs, and they included articles about everything from boy trouble to where to buy a good guitar or how to make a good vegan burrito. They also took on some serious issues too, like abuse and reproductive rights. There were hundreds of Riot Girl fanzines with names like Wiglet, Quit Whining, and Girl Germs. Bikini Kill fanzines were sold at their shows, and they contained the Riot Girl Manifesto, which outlined the movement's grievances and defined its goals. Because in every form of media, I see myself slapped, decapitated, laughed at, objectified, raped, trivialized, pushed, ignored, stereotyped, kicked, scorned, molested, silenced, invalidated, knifed, shot, choked, and killed. Because I am tired of these things happening to me. I am not a punching bag. I am not a joke. Because every time we pick up a pen or an instrument or get anything done, we are creating the revolution. We are the revolution. This was all happening at a time when traditional feminism was considered by some as undesirable and inaccessible. A 1991 book by journalist Susan Faludi called Backlash made waves for pointing out the ways that society and the media had turned feminists into a negative stereotype after the feminism wave of the 70s. Feminism was largely the domain of academia. The women's movement didn't have a language for reaching young girls. The language and ideas of Riot Girl suddenly made feminism more accessible. In a 2016 Vice article, writer Jenny Stevens said that Kathleen Hanna once told her that her goal was to make feminism something that could be approached by all women, not just well-off white university grads. What started off as an underground movement soon attracted the attention of mainstream media. After the Riot Girl movement was featured in the LA Weekly in July 1992, other media outlets wanted a piece of them. Stories appeared in Rolling Stone, New York Times, and Playboy. A 1992 article in Newsweek magazine called the Riot Girls a new feminist voice for the video age generation. With this heightened awareness of the Riot Girl movement came a lot of unwanted attention as well. Articles trivialized the movement by focusing on what members wore and how they cut their hair. Riot Girl was categorized as feminist fury, in-your-face feminism, and mean, mad, and defiantly underground. The media pigeonholed them as combat boot-wearing man-haters, angry rape and incest survivors, former sex workers, and caricatures of girlhood. And the Riot Girl radical feminist philosophy quickly got watered down. Girls all over the country started to emulate Riot Girl media celebrities like Kathleen Hanna by wearing army boots and dyeing their hair crazy colors without the slightest idea about what feminism was or why it was important. Even the teen magazine 17 tried to cash in on the movement. According to a 2013 article in The Guardian, the teen mag handed out little plastic cards with these words on them. If you like Bratmobile or Bikini Kill or Hole, then you'll like 17 too. The result was a media blackout, called by Kathleen Hanna in 1992. The decision eventually caused the movement to fragment, and then amid the growing popularity of the grunge scene, the Riot Grrrl movement dissolved. Riot Grrrl was painted as just another fashion craze rather than a legit feminist movement. Author Allison Yarrow believes, despite its short lifespan, the Riot Grrrl movement had a major impact on 90s music, leading to the rise of musicians like Alanis Morissette, Paula Cole, and Lisa Loeb.
What we come to think of now as mainstream 90s musicians really kind of came out of the Riot Grrrl movement in a way, because what the Riot Grrrl movement did is that it really validated female anger for the first time and allowed it to emerge in the public consciousness. The public became aware that female anger was real.
The Riot Grrrl movement may have been the first to use the term girl power, but five girls from the UK took it global. In February 1994, the London-based father-son management team of Bob and Chris Herbert published an ad in a British trade magazine looking for performers for an all-female pop group. The ad asked, "Are you 18 to 23 with the ability to dance or sing? Are you streetwise, outgoing, ambitious, and dedicated?" 1 month later, hundreds of eager young women answered the ad and showed up to audition. Five were selected: Victoria Adams, Melanie Brown, Melanie Chisholm, Jerry Halliwell, and Michelle Stevenson. That's right, no Emma Bunton. She came a little bit later. And they weren't called Spice Girls at first. The band's original name was Touch. Within a few months, it was decided that Michelle Stevenson wasn't a good fit for the group, so she was cut. And in came Emma Bunton. The five members of Touch lived together and spent their days in studio taking dancing and singing lessons. The girls spent nearly a year rehearsing the same four songs. During that time, the songs Wannabe and To Become One were written and recorded. And not long after that, the soon-to-be Spice Girls pulled their first girl power move, led by Jerry. They were growing more and more unhappy with their 23-year-old manager, Chris Herbert. So they did what any enterprising young band would do. In a scene straight out of the Spice Girls movie, they stole their master recordings from their management's office and started looking for a new manager on their own. According to David Sinclair in his book, Wannabe, How the Spice Girls Reinvented Pop Fame, Jerry and the two Mels went to the management offices, and by means that remain unclear to this day, they managed to retrieve the master recordings of their songs. Meantime, Victoria and Emma went to the studio where they'd been working to collect various odds and ends that belonged to the group, and the heist was complete. The band, which was now called Spice, soon found a home with Simon Fuller, who managed the career of Annie Lennox, and the girls signed their first major deal with Virgin Records in September 1995. That's where Ginger, Sporty, Scary, Baby, and Posh officially became the Spice Girls. According to a 2017 article on Up Rocks, this was a really important moment for the Spice Girls. This is when they took control of their brand and began heading in the feminist direction that would ultimately define their career and introduce the world to the brand of girl power. Wannabe took on a life of its own when it was first released. It was an instant hit with fangirls and some fanboys who loved its empowering message. Female friendships are everything. The Spice Girls were the original girl squad. They were strong, independent women who wore what they wanted, whether it was a baby doll dress or an Adidas tracksuit. Wannabe topped the charts for 4 weeks in North America and 7 weeks in the UK. That made the Spice Girls the first female group ever to top the charts with a debut single. It went to number one in 30 countries and sold over 6 million copies in 1996. Their second and third singles, Say You'll Be There and To Become One, also topped the charts. Following their massive commercial success, the Spice Girls began to build out their girl power image even more. Emma Bunton summed up the ethos this way. Girl power is about being whoever you want to be, wearing your short skirts, your wonder bra, and your makeup, but having something to say as well. Okay, so let's talk about some of the group's biggest girl power moments, and there's a few of them. On February 24th, 1997, the Spice Girls won two Brit Awards and performed live at the show. You may remember the buzz around what Jerry wore on stage that night, a skimpy Union Jack dress. Jerry apparently made the dress out of a tea towel two nights before the awards show. That dress became an iconic and a little bit controversial symbol of the band. But there was something else going on that night at the awards show, which was even more memorable. Prior to the ceremony, Liam Gallagher of Oasis stated in the British media that he wasn't going to go to the Brit Awards because if he bumped into the Spice Girls, he would smack them. So during the band's acceptance speech for Best British Single, Sporty, or Mel C, challenged Gallagher by saying, "I just want to say, Liam, come and have a go if you think you're hard enough." The girls seemed to have a general no boys allowed attitude, and they let interviewers know that, particularly male ones. When an American radio DJ asked the girls about picking up guys, Mel B, or Scary Spice, responded with a bit of a smackdown. She shouted, "Excuse me, this is about girl power. This isn't about picking up guys. We don't need men to control our lives. We control our lives anyway." There were things happening behind the scenes, too. In recent years, a leaked video made the rounds on social media that showed the girls taking on the director of a Polaroid commercial they were filming in 1997. Victoria, Mel B, and Jerry can be seen giving him the gears after he asked them to show more cleavage and midriff. In the footage, Mel B can be seen marching up to the director and asking, "Was it you? Why did you ask that we show cleavage and midriffs?" He replies, "It's every man's fantasy," before adding, "That's showbiz." Jerry points a finger in his face and calls him a chauvinistic pig, while Victoria steals his sunglasses. "It's not sunny," she says, pulling his sunglasses from his head. "Stop trying to look cool." As a final dig to the director, Jerry tells him he should know better at his age. For what it's worth, the final version of the 90s commercial did not include any cleavage or midriff. Auntie Donahue is an author and media personality who writes about the power of pop culture. She's also an admitted Spice Girls superfan. And she says that as a kid, she didn't realize what a big deal it was to see them push back in the ways that they did.
It was when I was an adult, though, and kind of like re-examining their place in pop culture that, like, you do realize how rare it was for very, very, very famous women to break from protocol and act out and call out in a way that they tended to do.
Sometimes speaking out landed them in hot water. In 1996, Jerry was criticized when she said British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher was the first Spice Girl and that she was the pioneer of girl power. Feminists took offense to the comment because Thatcher, as Britain's first female prime minister, promoted only one woman to cabinet, and many of her policies had negative impacts on ordinary women. And according to her own advisor, Paul Johnson, Thatcher openly stated that she hated feminism, calling it poison. More recently, Jerry sparked controversy again after Thatcher's death in 2013. Jerry tweeted, "Thinking of our first lady of girl power, Margaret Thatcher, a greengrocer's daughter who taught me anything is possible." Jerry quickly deleted the tweet after she was inundated with negative responses. But then in a subsequent blog post, Jerry expressed regret over deleting her tweet, saying, "Now I realize that I do admire a woman, whether she is right or wrong, regardless of her opinions. I look at my behavior, which exposed how weak I was under fire, not like Margaret Thatcher. Auntie Donahue said back when she was 12, she viewed the Spice Girls as the cool older sisters who did whatever they wanted.
Oh, you can live this way? You can dress however you want. You can live on a Spice bus. Like, you can wear platform shoes everywhere. You can, like, have candy for dinner. Like, it was this idea of, like, girlhood and womanhood that you never see outside of the cultural, like, pop culture and that landscape, I'd say.
Donahue says the Spice Girls also helped to normalize casual and responsible sex. She believes the band used their public presence to push a sex-positive message that wasn't being told by many other female pop performers in the 90s. She points to the song, To Become One.
They literally say, like, come a little bit closer, baby, put it on. And so I remember being 12 and knowing what they meant, but not knowing what they meant. Like, you don't really know, but you kind of know. I'm thinking, like, oh, my God, how scandalous is that?
The Spice Girls may have been associated with female empowerment back in the day, but according to Mel C, they never initially intended to bring girl power to the world. In a 2018 interview with Female First, Mel C said that girl power was created by the sexism that the Spice Girls encountered in the music business in the 90s. She said, when we started, we were a pop group and we just wanted to sing and be famous and travel the world. And we never really thought about that side of things at all. But as soon as we were heading into the music industry, we started to be faced with some sexism. We were told girls don't sell. We would go into magazines and editors would tell us, we can't put you on the cover because we won't sell enough magazines this week. Mel C went on to say, that really made us have a bee in our bonnets. And that's when we started talking about girl power. We realized we had something really important to say. It gave us even more determination to succeed because we realized very early on we weren't just doing it for ourselves and each other. We were doing it for girls. Being told we couldn't do something was like a red rag to a bull to the Spice Girls. So where did the Spice Girls come up with the girl power slogan? Is it possible they were tuned in to the Riot Girl movement across the Atlantic? Well, Ginger Spice says, no way. That's not how they came up with the popular mantra. In 2016, Vice writer Jenny Stevens asked Jerry if she'd ever heard of Kathleen Hanna and Riot Girl. Jerry apparently looked confused and shook her head no. So Stevens asked Jerry where girl power came from. She said, from the band Shampoo. Shampoo was a 90s British pop-punk female duo somewhere in between Riot Girl and the Spice Girls. They wore shirts that said Tart and Dolly Bird on them. They were wild, outrageous, and rebellious. And the title track for their 1996 album was called Girl Power. In a 1997 Spice Girls documentary called 1 Hour of Girl Power, Mel B described girl power this way. It's about spreading a positive vibe, kicking it for the girls. Critics were quick to pounce on the Spice Girls for using their platform to promote girl power. They called it a packaged, watered-down form of feminism. Feminist writers condemned the band for promoting a light and frothy feminism that they called feminism light, because it detracted from the real issues of gender politics. According to Caitlin Moran, the author of How to Be a Woman, the Spice Girls were responsible for wiping out feminism for a decade. She told The Guardian their frivolous girl power rhetoric simplified the women's movement to having girlfriends and wearing short skirts. Author Alison Yarrow, on the other hand, sees both the pros and the cons to the Spice Girls' message.
The Spice Girls absolutely helped introduce 90s girls to the idea of girl power, and to frankly to the qualities of girl power that could feel good and could be empowering for them. But at the same time, it was kind of a mixed message because they were so overtly objectified and sexualized. And, you know, anytime something is for sale, that's not feminism.
And sell they did. After the success of Wannabe, suddenly everyone wanted a piece of girl power. And in 1997, they very quickly had their own Spice Girls dolls, as well as sponsorships and merchandise deals with brands like Chupa Chups, Impulse Deodorant, and Pepsi. According to Rolling Stone, in the 90s, the girls made up to $75 million a year, thanks to touring, merchandising, and the iconic Spice World movie. It was hard not to question whether the Spice Girls' girl power was authentic or just another way to sell stuff to young consumers. There are other aspects of the Spice Girls that have been viewed as problematic. In an article on Refinery29, writer Ariana Davis points out that the girls' nicknames reinforce the stereotype that women have to fall into specific personality boxes. There's the innocent girly girl, baby, the tomboy, sporty, the stylish sex kitten, posh, the fiery one, ginger, and the outspoken black woman, scary. Those archetypes are as old as time and played into traditional views of womanhood. But Davis acknowledges that others may have seen it differently. For some, sporty showed they didn't have to be the girly girl to be accepted. While for young brown girls like herself, scary was an outspoken black feminist icon at a time before performers like Beyoncé and Lizzo existed. And there is no denying that Spice Girls were a gateway to feminism for some young girls. The term girl power was easy to digest and easy to understand. Yes, it fit nicely on a pencil case or a t-shirt, but that made it all the more accessible to young girls. Auntie Donahue thinks Spice Girls were a good first step toward being proud to identify as a girl.
They were a good catchphrase that sometimes I think you need when you're small, but that can't be your only feminist leaning, because there's nothing there other than, like, girls can do what they want, but it's like, they can't, though. That's that is the catch.
Since the 90s, when Spice Girls were promoting girl power, teen girls have continued to struggle with self-esteem. Here's Allison Yarrow again.
As long as the sort of mainstream media we consume, be it, you know, teen magazines in the 90s or social media today, these platforms have tremendous power. And when they present images of, you know, quote unquote, successful womanhood that looks like sort of objectified bodies and overtly sexualized, sort of pandering to the male gaze, female bodies, that's really toxic for young women, whether it's in the 90s or now.
One bright spot is that women in pop music have made huge strides since the 90s. The pop world is dominated, not just by women, but by women who publicly identify as feminists. Artists like Taylor Swift, Miley Cyrus, and Beyoncé, who memorably stood in front of a giant feminist sign blazing from behind her silhouette at the 2014 MTV Music Video Awards. A moment that Time magazine said reclaimed the term from its troubled past. What Bey just did for feminism on national television, look, for better or for worse, that reach is way more than anything we've seen, declared Roxane Gay, author of The Bad Feminist, on Twitter. She also recently noted that other celebrity feminists like Jennifer Lawrence and Lena Dunham have reclaimed and rebranded feminism, making it more palatable to people who may still have some negative associations with the word. In 2016, the Spice Girls' iconic hit, Wannabe, was used as part of the UN's Project Everyone. The campaign used the original recording by the Spice Girls, but with a new girl power emphasis. In the video, a diverse group of female singers and actors, including Canadian YouTube star Taylor Fatala, lip-sync and dance to the song against backdrops with signs calling for equal pay and an end to violence against women from all around the world. The 21st Century Wannabe has over 2 million views on YouTube, where the accompanying blurb urges viewers to share a photo with a sign stating what you really, really want for girls and women. This year, when the Spice Girls, minus Victoria Beckham, went on tour, they expanded their message from girl power to people power, welcoming all ages, races, identities, countries of origin, sexual orientations, religions, and abilities. Emma Bunton said the Spice Girls in 2019 are about equality and bringing everyone together. Girl power, like Beyoncé's feminist moment, was a gateway to many girls' first taste towards empowerment. And there will be more in the future who will do this as well. However, as Roxane Gay said in The Guardian in 2014, there's nothing wrong with famous women or men claiming the cause. But the feminist brand ambassadors are a gateway to feminism, not the movement itself. So what began in the Pacific Northwest with Kathleen Hanna and a reaction to a male-dominated punk rock scene has morphed and changed in so many ways over the years, for better and for worse. But what cannot be denied is that girl power became part of our common consciousness in the 90s, and its lasting effect is heard in the discussions we're having now, almost 30 years later. Thanks for joining me on this look at girl power in the 90s. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. And while you're there, don't forget to rate and review us. It helps spread the word and get more people to find the podcast. We're available for free at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and everywhere else you get your streaming audio. You can also listen at curiouscast.ca. Be sure to check out the show notes for more information about what you've heard on this episode and links to our guests, Allison Yarrow and Anne T. Donahue. If you want to reach out to me, you can find me on Twitter at 1990s History and Instagram and Facebook. You can also email me at 90s@curiouscast.ca. That's 90s@curiouscast.ca. This show is hosted and co-written by me, Kathy Kinzora, and Dila Velasquez, our producer. Sound design and final production is by Rob Johnston. See you next time for more history of the 90s. When Bruce Pavitt, the head of Seattle indie label Sub Pop, came up with the idea for a concert that would showcase three of the city's hottest bands, people thought he was nuts. Local Seattle bands in the late 80s play dingy basement clubs for an audience of 20 or 30 people, not big theaters that could hold 1,400 people. But Pavitt pushed ahead with the show he called Lame Fest, which he ironically described as Seattle's lamest bands in a one-night orgy of sweat and insanity. Much to everyone's surprise, Lame Fest featuring Nirvana, Tad, and Mudhoney completely sold out. And if anyone was paying attention outside of Seattle, it might have been a signal that a new type of music was about to come crashing onto the scene. I'm Kathy Kinzora, and this is History of the 90s, a podcast about a decade that changed the world. On this episode, part one of a two-part series on the rise and fall of the generation-defining musical revolution known as grunge. For the uninitiated, grunge begins and ends with Kurt Cobain and Nirvana. Maybe sprinkle in a little Pearl Jam or Soundgarden and a few flannels, and that's grunge. A moment in time that has long passed, but frozen in our memories because of Cobain's early death. But grunge is so much more than one band and one singer, who, yes, had an outsized impact on the movement, but was just one piece of an entire genre of music and an attitude that captivated the world at the beginning of the 90s. So let's go back to the beginning and start off by looking at where the term grunge came from and what it stood for. The first noted use of grunge to describe a Seattle band appears to date back to 1981. According to the book Loser, The Real Seattle Music Story by Clark Humphrey, grunge was first used in a letter by Mark Arm, who would later go on to front grunge bands Green River and Mudhoney. In the 1981 letter to a Seattle fanzine called Desperate Times, Arm mockingly wrote about his current band, "I hate Mr. Epp and the calculations. Pure grunge, pure noise, pure shit." Arm himself has pushed back on this idea that he invented the term grunge as a genre of music. He says he must have gotten it from somewhere else. Whether or not he came up with the term, Arm has an undeniable connection to the early grunge scene in Seattle. In 1984, he co-founded Green River, which is considered to be one of the first grunge bands. It featured Jeff Ament on bass and Stone Gossard on guitar, who would later form Pearl Jam. Green River recorded an EP called Dry as a Bone on Seattle-based indie label Sub Pop, which was headed by Bruce Pavitt. Pavitt has long claimed that he popularized the term grunge in promotional material that he wrote for the 1986 EP. He described the band as ultra-loose grunge that destroyed the morals of a generation. So we might not have a perfect answer regarding who came up with the term grunge as a style of music or who used it first, but I think we can agree on two things. Today, the word grunge is synonymous with the Seattle music scene of the 80s and early 90s. And even though that Seattle sound splintered off into several different distinct styles, we can also agree that the earliest grunge all shared a pretty similar sound. Joining me to talk about grunge is Alan Cross. He's an internationally known broadcaster, interviewer, writer, consultant, blogger, and speaker. In his nearly 40 years in the broadcasting and music business, Alan has interviewed the biggest names in rock and is also known as a musicologist and documentarian through programs like the long-running show and podcast, The Ongoing History of New Music.
Grunge came about in the early 1980s, featuring a low-tuned guitar, something maybe a little slow and sludgy at times, sometimes with screamy vocals. But basically what it was is taking what Black Sabbath had done in the 1970s, added a little bit of Kiss, a little bit of Judas Priest, a tiny bit of Led Zeppelin, and created this menacing, well, in most cases menacing, low and slow kind of guitar rock.
There were high levels of distortion, feedback, and fuzz effects in a fusion of punk and metal that grew out of the fact that Seattle was off the beaten path and a lot of bigger mainstream acts didn't want to travel there.
What we ended up seeing was a movement of music north-south. So from Seattle down to Los Angeles and back, sort of hemmed in by the Rocky Mountains. And what would happen is that a lot of the bands from San Francisco and from Los Angeles and other areas to the south, instead of touring east, they would go up the coast. And this brought the punk rock hardcore attitude of Southern California and Central California north. So these were some of the only bands that would play in the Seattle area. And because they were the only bands, they had an outsized influence on the young people growing up and going to these shows. So that added a really interesting punk rock element to what already existed, which was this combination of Black Sabbath, Kiss, Judas Priest, and Led Zeppelin.
Another part of the reason these early grunge bands had a similar sound was because many of them were produced by Jack Endino, the so-called godfather of grunge. Endino worked out of Reciprocal Recording Studios, a small, unassuming, triangular-shaped building that had previously been a corner grocery store in an industrial neighborhood of Seattle. It didn't look like much, but in its heyday, it was the epicenter for grunge music. In its short run, the studio hosted a who's who of the Seattle grunge scene, and along the way, changed the trajectory of music history. Reciprocal Recording was first started by Chris Hanzik and Tina Caselli in 1983. Hanzik had relocated from Boston to Seattle after hearing from friends about the city's growing underground music scene. There were a ton of local bands, like the Melvins, the U-Men, and Green River, but there weren't many places to record. So in 1984, Hanzik and Caselli opened Reciprocal Recording with the goal of getting some of those bands into the studio. With its $10 an hour recording rate, Reciprocal was immediately popular with local musicians. Between 1984 and 1989, the studio recorded many legendary grunge bands, including Soundgarden, Mudhoney, Nirvana, and Blood Circus. In 1985, Hanzik and Caselli also started a record label called CZ Records. And before selling the label to focus exclusively on the recording studio, they released a compilation album featuring some of the local talent in Seattle. The album, called Deep Six, was released in March 1986 and featured Green River, The U-Men, Skin Yard, Malfunction, Soundgarden, and The Melvins. The album had a limited edition run of 2,000 copies, and although it has become the stuff of legends as one of the first important records in the history of grunge, at the time it was ignored for the most part outside of Seattle. Deep Six perfectly captured what was happening in Seattle's underground music scene in the mid-80s. Long-haired musicians wailing away in front of tiny crowds at squalid clubs like the Central Tavern or Squid Row. It was a tight-knit group of Seattle-area bands. They broke up, members changed, new bands were formed, but it was a small circle of the same people cycling through. In addition to CZ Records, there was also Sub Pop, the indie label that was home to Green River and headed up by Bruce Pavitt. Pavitt, who I mentioned earlier, had an extremely influential role in the growth of the Seattle grunge scene. He started out in 1980 as a college student in Olympia, Washington, making a fanzine called Subterranean Pop, which promoted underground bands and independent records. Pavitt moved to Seattle in 1983 and converted the fanzine into a regular music column called Sub Pop that appeared in the local paper. He released a handful of records, including Sub Pop 100 in July 1986, which was a compilation album. He also released an EP called Screaming Life by a little-known band at the time called Soundgarden. After Pavitt's business partner, friend, and local band promoter, Jonathan Poneman, borrowed $20,000 to make it official, the label formally launched in 1988 as Sub Pop Records. That same year, Sub Pop launched the legendary Singles Club, which was like today's subscription services, but way cooler. For a set fee paid up front, fans were promised a certain number of limited edition, hand-numbered vinyl 7-inch 45s sent to them via mail in the course of 6 months or a year. A flyer for the service that was included inside Sub Pop Records read, "Hey loser, wanna find some action? Tired of being left out? Here at Sub Pop, we've started a special club for lonely record collectors like yourself. Every other month, we'll send you two limited edition 45s. All you have to do is send us your money."
Now, what was interesting about the Sub Pop Music Club was that it was the first place where you would find this new band called Nirvana, who covered a song called Love Buzz by a Dutch band called Shocking Blue. And only 1,000 copies were sent out. And then, of course, later on, Nirvana blew up. And if you can find a copy of Love Buzz, the original Sub Pop Singles Club issue, you got a really expensive collector's item.
In addition to the Nirvana single, the Sub Pop Record Club sent out 62 singles over 5 years, from 1988 to 1993, from bands like Fugazi, Sonic Youth, and Soundgarden. By the late 80s, the Seattle music scene was definitely buzzing, but Bruce Pavitt was convinced it could go even bigger. He decided to showcase three of his bands at an event he called Lamefest. Held at the historic Moore Theater, the concert featured Mudhoney, which had been formed by Mark Arm and Steve Turner after Green River split up, as well as two other up-and-coming groups called Tad and Nirvana. The show was a big risk. People thought Pavitt was crazy, The Moore Theater was a way bigger venue than any of the bands had ever played before. But to the surprise of many, the show totally sold out. Nirvana, who had just released their debut record, Bleach, on Sub Pop, opened the all-ages concert, and according to a review in the local zine Backlash, despite having sound issues, the band played a totally intense show. The review described it this way: hair explosions, pratfalls, jumps, body writing, and a trash-a-thon finale that left instruments and bodies strewn about the stage. At one point, Kurt Cobain jumped into the drum kit and got his hair tangled around his guitar strings. But he kept on playing, even swinging his guitar as he walked around the stage. Here's how it sounded. Next on the bill that night, followed by headliners Mudhoney, who had to stop three times during their set because of some pushing and shoving between the crowd and bouncers, who tried to prevent fans from climbing the stage so they could jump off. According to the website Northwest Passage, at one point, Mark Arm kicked a security guard in the back. Meantime, Kurt Cobain was standing at the side of the stage watching with Tad bassist Kurt Danielson. According to Northwest Passage, Cobain told Danielson that he liked to pogo to Mudhoney. He wondered why more people didn't pogo anymore. Now, if you don't know what pogo is, legend has it Sid Vicious of the Sex Pistols was the first to pogo in 1976. But either way, it came out of the British punk scene and involves people jumping up and down while either remaining on the spot or moving around. As you can imagine, it takes its name from the use of a pogo stick and was a precursor to moshing. That night at the Moore Theater, Cobain proceeded to jump up and down as Mudhoney played, and soon many people in the crowd joined him. Fans loved the show, but critics, well, they weren't as impressed. A review in the Seattle Times by critic Paul DeBarros said, "If this is the future of rock and roll, I hope I die before I get much older." But organizer Bruce Pavitt was unfazed. To him, Lamefest was a turning point in Seattle's music scene. The fact that three local bands were able to sell out such a large venue encouraged Pavitt to keep pushing forward and to generate more interest outside of the Pacific Northwest. Starting in October 1989, Nirvana and Tad crisscrossed Europe together. And a month later, Mudhoney embarked on their own overseas tour that started in the UK. By December 1989, all three bands met up again to share the stage at the Astoria Theatre in London for Lamefest UK. Their days of playing gigs in front of 20 or 30 people appeared to be over. Meanwhile, another Seattle band born out of the Green River breakup was also gaining momentum. Mother Love Bone was made up of Jeff Ament, Stone Gossard, and Bruce Fairweather, formerly of Green River, as well as Greg Gilmore on drums, and Andrew Wood, previously with the band Malfunction, handling vocals. In March 1989, the band released the EP Shine. Shine was released on PolyGram subsidiary Mercury Stardog, making it the first major label release from the booming local Seattle scene. After the EP was out, the band relocated to San Francisco to record its first full album. There was a lot of buzz around Mother Love Bone, who, like other Seattle bands, was a blend of influences from Led Zeppelin to Guns N' Roses. But what made them really stand out was their high-energy stage presence, especially charismatic frontman Andrew Wood, who seemed to be channeling 70s arena rock stars like Freddie Mercury and Paul Stanley. Here's Alan Cross.
When Mother Love Bone was signed, this was a call to other record labels to go out into the Pacific Northwest and see what they could find. Remember, though, that this is the middle 80s, and we were in the middle of a huge pop boom. So guitar rock really wasn't selling unless it was from the Sunset Strip, wore spandex makeup, and had cool haircuts. That was the big thing. This idea of these dark sort of Sabbath-y bands coming out of Seattle, like, big deal, because that was something, you know, from 10 years ago, nobody was interested in. It was all about hair metal and so on. But when Mother Love Bone threatened to break through, that started to affect labels' opinions of what was actually going on in Seattle.
It's not really a stretch to say that without Mother Love Bone, there might not have been a gold rush to Seattle that led to the mainstream breakthrough that came a couple of years later. The next Seattle band with a major label release was Soundgarden. Lead singer Chris Cornell was actually roommates with Mother Love Bone singer Andrew Wood. Soundgarden had been on the scene for about 5 years, and in addition to a few tracks on the Deep Six compilation album, they had also released a couple of singles and EPs with Sub Pop before switching over to independent label SST, where they released their debut album Ultra Mega OK. Cornell and band members weren't happy with SST and signed on with A&M Records, who released Soundgarden's first major label record, Louder Than Love, in September 1989. The lead-off single was Loud Love. Around this time, another Seattle group, Alice in Chains, picked up a major label deal with Columbia, and they put out We Die Young, their first EP, in 1990. So things were definitely heating up in the Pacific Northwest. It felt like a major breakthrough was imminent. But not by Kurt Cobain and Nirvana. They were still just a bunch of scruffy indie musicians touring around in a rusty old van. And not by Pearl Jam. They didn't even exist yet. Instead, it was Mother Love Bone that was expected to become the next big rock band. The release of their major label debut album, Apple, was just weeks away. Then, tragedy struck. On March 16th, 1990, Andrew Wood's girlfriend found him unconscious. He had overdosed on heroin. Wood had struggled with addiction since the malfunction days, and at some point during 1989, he had given rehab a shot. After being discovered by his girlfriend, Wood was taken to hospital and put on life support, which allowed his roommate and best friend, Chris Cornell, time to fly back to Seattle to say his goodbyes. Wood died on March 19th, 1990. He was 24 years old. Years later, Cornell said in a documentary about Wood that the passing of his friend was the death of the innocence of the Seattle music scene. He said it wasn't what came 4 years later. It was that day, the day he walked into the hospital room and saw Wood on life support. Wood's death also had a major impact on the trajectory of the Seattle music scene. Some believe maybe even more so than the death of Cobain. Following Wood's death, when Apple finally dropped after a three-month delay, critics both raved about the music and bemoaned the loss of what could have been. Chris Cornell told Rolling Stone that after Wood's funeral, he was swept up in grief for a couple of weeks before he turned to writing. That's when Cornell wrote two songs for his former roommate, Say Hello to Heaven and Reach Down. Cornell says the lyrics specifically reflected Wood and his feelings about him. He didn't let anything else in, calling the experience precious. He approached Wood's bandmates Stone Gossard and Jeff Ament about recording the two tracks as a tribute single. Gossard and Ament had dissolved Mother Love Bone and were in the process of creating a new band with guitarist Mike McCready called Mookie Blaylock. Yes, after that famous basketball player. Gossard and Ament agreed to join Cornell and Soundgarden drummer Matt Cameron in the studio to lay down the two tracks, and at the last minute decided to bring along a 24-year-old San Diego-based singer who was in town auditioning for their new band, Mookie Blaylock. His name was Eddie Vedder. By the time the guys assembled at London Bridge Studios in Seattle, Washington, in November 1990, 8 months after Wood's death, Cornell had written an album's worth of material. So what started as a single turned into the one-off album and band, Temple of the Dog, named after a line in the Mother Love Bone song, Man of Golden Words. All 10 songs were recorded over a 15-day span in November and December 1990. The last track that was added to the album was the hit song, Hunger Strike. Chris Cornell told Rolling Stone that he thought the song would be a good message to end the album on. But initially, it didn't feel complete because it was just one verse. Then one day when Cornell was singing the chorus in the rehearsal space, Eddie Vedder just kind of shyly walked up to the mic and started singing the low, I'm going hungry part, and Cornell started singing the high part. And just like that, the whole thing came together. When the recording sessions for Temple of the Dog wrapped up, Cornell and Cameron returned to Soundgarden, and the rest of the guys returned to Mookie Blaylock. And following a quick name change, they became Pearl Jam. Temple of the Dog hit shelves on April 16, 1991. The album got great reviews, but didn't chart, and initially sold just 70,000 copies. But that would change the next year after Pearl Jam and Soundgarden became two of the hottest bands in the country. A&M reissued Temple of the Dog and Hunger Strike went into heavy rotation on MTV. The album peaked at number 5 on the Billboard 200 following its second release and went on to sell more than a million copies. Okay, don't worry, I haven't forgotten about that other important grunge band. Around the time Temple of the Dog were in the studio recording their tribute to Andy Wood, Nirvana, which consisted only of Kurt Cobain and Chris Novoselic, were on the hunt for a full-time drummer. They were eventually introduced to 21-year-old Dave Grohl through their friends, the Melvins. Grohl was already a veteran of the Washington rock scene, having played a stint with the punk band Scream. It was actually at a Scream gig that Cobain first spotted Grohl and was blown away by his energy. Shortly after, Cobain and Novoselic invited Grohl out to Seattle, where he arrived in September 1990. They went to a local studio for a jam sesh, and Novoselic says in the Nirvana biography, Come As You Are, they knew within 2 minutes that Grohl was the right drummer. He was the missing link that they'd been looking for. Just over 6 months later, they would sign a major record deal with Geffen. After Andrew Wood's death, there were many in the Seattle music scene, like Chris Cornell, who felt like it was the end of an era. The grunge movement of the 80s was dead. But for the rest of North America and the world at large, grunge was just about to arrive. And when it landed, it slammed into the earth like an asteroid, blowing up everything in its path. Here's Alan Cross.
Nobody was ready for the sound that was coming from Seattle. Simply because nobody anticipated the huge demographic shift that we were going to see in the music consumer. So we moved from the classic rock people and the hair metal people quite suddenly over to Generation X, who was, at the beginning of the 90s, not a very good place. First of all, they were overeducated and underemployed. They were genuinely afraid that for the first time in many, many decades, their standard of living would not even reach the same level, let alone exceed that of their parents. And there was a lot of weird stuff going on. We had the Gulf War. We had a terrible recession. These people were very, very concerned about where their lives were going to go in the new decade as we counted down the days to the end of the century and the end of the millennium. And it just so happens that this music, this angsty music from the Pacific Northwest, perfectly express their wants, needs, desires, fears, and concerns, and anger. And very, very suddenly, and to the sheer, utter shock of the entire music community, grunge blew up.
In the fall of 1991, within the span of barely over a month, 3 albums were issued in rapid succession, and rock music would experience one of its biggest and quickest shifts ever. With the arrival of Pearl Jam's 10, Nirvana's Nevermind, and Soundgarden's Bad Motorfinger, the hair metal of the 80s was dead. Suddenly, flannel shirts, Doc Martens, shredded jeans, and secondhand guitars replaced spandex, eyeliner, mile-high hair, and sharp, pointy guitars. While we're here, why don't we take a minute to talk about grunge fashion? The look associated with the bands that came out of the Pacific Northwest grew out of necessity rather than a need to make some kind of non-fashion statement. Long before Macklemore sang about popping tags, thrifting was a verb in Seattle, especially for members of struggling underground bands like Nirvana. They were dirt poor, so thrift shops were the only place they could afford to buy clothes. And what would you find in a Seattle thrift store? Flannel, ripped jeans, long johns, that sort of thing. The kind of clothes a lumberjack might wear and then donate when they were done with it. And those clothes were useful. A flannel shirt worn around the waist is a precaution against the Pacific Northwest's unpredictable weather. Army boots are great for slogging through the mud. As for the greasy-haired, unkempt look, well, that too wasn't necessarily a statement. Charles Cross, the editor of the Seattle music monthly The Rocket, says that Kurt Cobain was just too lazy to shampoo. And being dirt poor, he did a lot of couch surfing and even slept occasionally outdoors. Okay, back to the fall of 1991, when grunge was finally breaking through. Let's take a look back at the three albums that put Seattle on the map. First, there's Pearl Jam's 10. Released on August 27th, 1991, 10 included soon-to-be classics such as Alive, Jeremy, and Evenflow. And it established Eddie Vedder with his baritone roar as a superstar frontman. The album went on to sell more than 13 million. Over the next 30 minutes, chaos erupted. A Kettle and Stony Point band counselor was beaten unconscious. A school bus and a car were driven into police officers. And an activist was shot dead. He was the first Canadian killed in a land claims dispute in the 20th century. I'm Kathy Kinzora, and this is the history of the 90s. On this episode, a story about displacement, broken promises, and anger that could no longer be contained. This is the story of the Ipperwash crisis. To fully understand what happened in 1995, we have to go back even further, all the way back to 1942. That's when the Chippewa of Stony Point were part of the Anishinaabeg Nation. We're living on a small reserve beside Ipperwash Provincial Park. Ipperwash is in southwestern Ontario, on the south shore of Lake Huron, the third largest freshwater lake in the world. The area is stunning, with long stretches of beautiful beaches, beds of flint rock, and giant sand dunes. The Chippewa of Stony Point had been living on this small reserve since 1928, after selling the rest of their land to speculators who severely undervalued the property. The surrendered land was used to build summer homes and cottages and to create Ipperwash Provincial Park, a 148-acre campground. While Ipperwash Park was being built in 1932, the Stony Point Chippewa alerted government officials that the land contained burial grounds. The government promised the burial grounds would be fenced off and respected, but that never happened. This is an important piece of information, so I want you to hold on to that one for later. As World War II was being waged overseas, the Canadian federal government made another decision that impacted the Stony Point First Nation.
So in 1942, in the spring, the Department of National Defense was looking for somewhere to create an army training facility. And to go after First Nations land at that time, it was a bit of a no-brainer for them, I guess.
That's Monica Virtue. She's a researcher and a documentary filmmaker who's been working on projects related to Ipperwash for the past 15 years. She says using the Stony Point land for an army training facility served a much larger goal of the government.
I'm trying to think of how to explain this, but at the time, the Department of Indian Affairs existed solely to assimilate First Nations people into the Canadian population. Although they had a what's called a fiduciary duty, that's not what they were doing. They were working their hardest to sell off Indigenous land as quickly as they could so that they could absorb First Nations people into the Canadian population as quickly as they could.
After concluding that the reserve land occupied by the Stony Point First Nation would be an ideal location to train Army cadets from southern Ontario before they went overseas to fight in the war, the federal government asked the 18 families living on the land if they would move.
The First Nation said no. They voted against it. So then the Department of National Defense invoked the War Measures Act and took it forcefully. So this was against the will of the people. I mean, there's people still surviving today, and they can tell you much better than I can the impacts that had on the community. Like, it's still a very traumatic experience that when people talk about it, their voices shake.
On Thanksgiving weekend in 1942, the frame houses of the Stony Point people were put up on jacks, loaded onto trucks, and moved down the highway to their new home. Ironically, some of the men from the Stony Point Reserve weren't even home when this happened because they were overseas fighting for Canada in the war. In the book One Dead Indian by Peter Edwards, he recounts the experience of Pearl George. She was 21 years old when Stony Point families were moved off their reserve. Pearl George had spent the day working in the family's large garden, and when she came home, their house was up on jacks and their two log cabins were gone. She said they weren't told anything about what was going on. Levi Johnson, another Stony Point resident, says his home wasn't moved. It was bulldozed flat. That's because it was the only brick house on the reserve and it was too heavy to put onto blocks. The small frame church at the Stony Point Reserve was also leveled. The families were moved to the nearby Kettle Point Reserve. The two nations were forced to merge and became the Kettle and Stony Point First Nation.
The landscape at Stony Point is very sandy. There's a lot of dunes and it's bush and sand. And if you go further west down to Kettle Point, it's a lot more swampy. So when the people were moved from Stony Point, their houses put up on the backs of flatbed trucks, and the houses were delivered to Kettle Point, it wasn't the most ideal spot to put houses.
And the Stony Point families lost their right to graze cattle, hunt, or gather wood without getting the permission of the Kettle Point people. While the Kettle Point people were forced to give up half their land. Not surprisingly, there was a lot of tension between the two bands.
You're taking a First Nation that has a band membership of something like 2,300 people, and you're taking away half of their land base. So suddenly, you've got all those people that have to live on the same piece of land.
The Chippewa of Stony Point were promised the land would be returned. But again, that didn't happen. Instead, the federal government continued operating an Army cadet camp in Ipperwash for the next several decades.
The government was very sneaky about the way they worded things. They said within the documents that they would return Camp Ipperwash when the land was no longer needed. So that's a little vague. I know band members were under the impression that would happen directly after World War II ended, but that's not what happened. The Canadian government held on to Camp Ipperwash and kept using it throughout the Korean War. Right up until the 90s, they were using it as a cadet camp. I mean, the Department of National Defense, I'm sure, looked at it and thought they could justify what they were doing. And the legal terminology maybe supported them in a certain sense, but ethically, it was a much different story.
So that brings us up to 1993, when about 100 members of the original Stony Point First Nation got tired of waiting to get their land back, and they reoccupied the east end of Camp Ipperwash.
Out near the grenade ranges, people had started setting up pup tents and bringing in little trailers and then bigger trailers and then building little cabins. Some of those cabins are still there. You can see them decaying, but it started slowly. And then by 1995, some teens were in a school bus and rammed the gate at the actual barracks proper. And that's when it got really serious.
When that bus rammed into the gate at the barracks on July 28th, 1995, the government was already in the process of shutting down the base and only 50 or so military personnel remained. Their commander immediately ordered them to evacuate as soon as possible to avoid a confrontation. The activists were a small breakaway group, and they called themselves Stony Pointers. Among them was 36-year-old Dudley George. Dudley's family was one of the original 18 families moved off the Stony Point Reserve in 1942. Dudley was born Anthony O'Brien George on March 17, 1957, 15 years after his family had been forced out. He was the eighth of 10 children. Life wasn't easy for the George family after moving to Kettle Point. Dudley brother Sam said the kids always knew it broke their parents' hearts to be taken off their land. And their lives seemed to spiral down after the move. The George family was plagued with alcohol and drug addiction, suicide, abuse, and tragically, their home burned to the ground twice. Soon after the school bus incident, dozens of people from other First Nations reserves in Canada and the U.S. traveled to the Ipperwash Army camp to support the Stony Pointers. They continued to peacefully occupy the army camp for the rest of the summer. But then word began to spread in the area that the activists planned to expand their occupation to Ipperwash Provincial Park, which was right next to the military camp. The rumor was they would wait until after the Labor Day weekend when the park would be mostly empty. And that's exactly what they did. Within hours of the park closing on Monday, September 4th, about 35 activists moved into the park, including Dudley George. The reason for the occupation was they claimed federal Indian agents did not represent the Chippewa properly when the land was sold to speculators in 1928. They reasserted their claim that the park contained sacred burial grounds, and they were unhappy that the burial grounds hadn't been fenced off as promised when Ipperwash Park was built in the 30s. Basically, this sacred land had been allowed to become a campground where families pitched tents and roasted marshmallows. About 12 uniformed police officers in cruisers pulled up near the front entrance of the park around 9:30 that night. Tensions were high. Many of the activists carried clubs, sticks, or tree branches. And one smashed the back window of a police car with a crutch. That's when police decided to withdraw from the park. They wanted to let things cool off for the night. The men, women, children, and elders who occupied the park built a fire near the camp store and quietly celebrated their victory by telling stories, drinking coffee, and smoking cigarettes. Meantime, the Ontario Provincial Police were busy setting up a command post in the nearby small town of Forest, Ontario. And at Queen's Park, the seat of Ontario's provincial government, Premier Mike Harris and his cabinet ministers were being made aware of the occupation. The next day, September 5th, 1995, Mike Harris attended a pro-am golf game at the PGA's Canadian Open, where he was paired up with Fred Couples. While the Premier was golfing, an emergency meeting of high-level officials was held near Queen's Park. Harris's aide, Deb Hutton, attended the meeting on his behalf. And according to testimony at an inquiry that took place 10 years later, Hutton was very assertive and told those at the meeting that the Premier wanted swift action to end the occupation. A high-level bureaucrat testified that Hutton said the Premier's views were quite hawkish on the issue and he did not want to get into negotiations with the occupiers. At no point in the meeting was it suggested that a negotiator should be appointed to meet with the activists to discuss their grievances. In the end, no decision was made at that meeting about what should be done. Meantime, back at Ipperwash Park, as night fell on day two, the occupiers moved 10 or 12 picnic tables from inside the park to a sandy parking lot just outside. They wanted to claim the area as part of their territory because it helped create a barricade so that no one else could access the park. Police tried to stop them from setting it up, and one officer even rammed his cruiser into a table. Later that night, two intelligence officers who were in charge of photographing what was happening at the park had a disturbing conversation. I'm going to play it for you, but a quick warning. The officers used painful and racist language towards the protesters. It was taped by their own cameras, and it was revealed later at an inquiry into the occupation.
Still a lot of press down there?
No, there's no one down there. This here big fat Indian.
Camera's rolling.
Yeah.
We had this plan, you know. We thought if we could get 5 or 6 cases of Labatt's 50, we could bait them.
Yeah.
Then we'd have this big net at a pit. Creative thinking. Works in the south with watermelon.
As tensions grew at the park, the OPP called in its special paramilitary TRU team. TRU stands for Tactics and Rescue Unit. These guys are called in for extreme situations, like hostage takings and sniper attacks. 10 members of the unit were called in as backup in case frontline OPP officers needed any help. They were sent to another nearby provincial park to stand by just in case. The next day, following another meeting at Queen's Park, a decision was made to seek a court injunction to remove the protesters from the park as soon as possible. The Premier and several of his ministers gathered in the Premier's private dining room to discuss the situation just before noon on September 6th. It was less than 12 hours before the confrontation that would leave a protester dead at the hands of an OPP sniper. What exactly was said at this meeting would become the subject of much controversy for the next decade. But I'm going to leave that meeting for now. We'll get back to it in just a bit. Meanwhile, back at the park, police received a report in the early evening that would give them the reason they needed to make a move on the protesters. The problem was the information they received wasn't entirely accurate. The incident commander was told that a civilian's car traveling through the area had been damaged by protesters armed with automatic weapons. But here's what really happened. Gerald George, a Kettle and Stony Point band counselor who didn't approve of the protest, drove to Ipperwash to check out what was going on. He pulled up to the protesters in the sandy parking lot and asked for an update. But angry protesters yelled at him and threw a rock at his car. Gerald George drove to a police checkpoint in the area and reported the incident. Police say that Gerald told them protesters were armed with semi-automatic weapons and Molotov cocktails. Gerald later denied ever saying that. But either way, around this time, the OPP began arguing amongst themselves over what should be done next. It was finally decided to send in the crowd management unit, basically the riot squad. Their job was to clear the protesters from the parking lot by sending them back into the park. If they refused, they would be arrested. The TRU team, which had been waiting on standby, would be used to provide visuals and cover for the CMU. They were not to assume a tactical role. It was the first time that these two units were ever deployed together. Just before 10:30, 32 members of the CMU marched in a box formation down a dark road leading to the park. They were followed by an 8-officer arrest team, 2 canine teams, and 2 prisoner vans. As they approached the sandy parking lot, the officers lowered the face shields on their helmets. One of the first reporters on the scene that night was Peter Edwards from the Toronto Star.
There was no cover. I mean, it was a totally open road, and there was nowhere to flee. They said later that they feared that there was a machine gun in the park, an AK-47. There's no way in the world that any sane person would march with no cover directly into a machine gun. Like, they couldn't have believed that, and there was no machine gun. I mean, none of the police and none of the police vehicles and none of the houses and none of the trees were hit by bullets coming from the native side. And an AK-47 fires 600 bullets a minute, so there would have been something.
He's the author of the book I mentioned earlier called One Dead Indian. Edwards said it never made sense for the OPP to send officers down a dark road if they truly believed the protesters were armed with semi-automatic guns, as they maintained. From the side of the road, Kettle and Stony Point band counselor Cecil Bernard George watched police in riot gear marching shoulder to shoulder towards the park. His sister, brothers, and friends were inside. George used a walkie-talkie to tell them police were coming and it didn't look good. As police approached the parking lot, occupiers turned on spotlights and shone them at officers. Some of the occupiers ran back into the park and armed themselves with sticks and rocks. The CMU officers moved into the parking lot and the last of the occupiers retreated into the park. At this point, the police mission was complete. The protesters were out of the parking lot. The police should have yelled into the park to let protesters know that if they stayed inside the park, there would be no confrontation. But that didn't happen. So protesters thought that the police were going to move into the park, and some of them began throwing rocks and burning sticks. This is when things took a terrible turn. 41-year-old Cecil Bernard George, the band counselor who had radioed ahead, decided enough was enough. He was angry and frustrated that no police officers or anyone else had tried to talk to them about their concerns. He grabbed a steel pipe and decided to approach the OPP to talk to them. When he got near, someone gave the order to punch out. Officers began beating their batons on their shields and ran toward Cecil Bernard George. He swung at police with the pipe he was carrying, but he was quickly knocked down. Officers began kicking and hitting him with batons. George flailed his arms and kicked back. He said it was like being in the middle of a nightmare. He heard the sound of breaking glass, and he saw shadows all around hitting him. He thought they were determined to kill him. From inside the park, the occupiers watched in disbelief. George's sister Tina screamed in horror for somebody to do something. 15 occupiers moved from the park into the sandy parking lot in an effort to rescue Cecil Bernard George. Several altercations between police and the protesters took place simultaneously, but it was clear the occupiers would be overpowered easily. So someone yelled, "Get the school bus from inside the park." They thought the bus could be driven into the crowd of officers, splitting them up so Cecil George could be rescued. A 16-year-old boy named Nicholas Cottrell jumped into the bus, pushed away a dumpster, and plowed through the gate. The bus headed through the sandy parking lot towards the officers. Many of the officers climbed a fence. Others jumped into a ditch just to get away. The bus eventually came to a stop on its own, but then a car driven by activist Warren George came speeding out of the park and hit several police officers. They bounced off the hood and rolled onto the ground. Officers opened fire from multiple directions. 16-year-old Nicholas Cottrell heard the gunfire and then felt a burning pain in his back. He thought he'd been hit by one of the bullets. During all of this, True Team members remained in their positions on the edge of the parking lot. Acting Sergeant Kenneth Dean, head of the True Team, would testify later at his trial that he saw muzzle flashes from the bush at the side of the road near the parking lot. He shot at the muzzle flashes and then moved forward. At that point, he said he saw a man walk onto the roadway with a firearm. That man was Dudley George. Officer Dean said George shouldered the rifle in a half-crouched position and scanned the officers. He believed George was milliseconds away from firing. So that's when Dean discharged three shots from his semi-automatic gun. He says George faltered and then spun around and threw his gun into the bush. But reporter Peter Edwards says there's no way that's how things happened.
The angle of the bullet came into him. There was a bullet that went through his collarbone downwards, through ribs and then into his spine. And for that, the bullet to travel that angle, he'd have to be really contorted. And at the inquiry, what came across as the logical explanation was that he was hit in the back of his calf. There was a bullet wound there, and that he put his hand down from the opposite side onto the part of his calf where he was shot. And that suggests that he was running away. Like the bullet hit his calf from behind, and he spun around to put his hand on the calf, and then he was shot.
Several occupiers came out of the park and carried Dudley George away. They called 911, but police wouldn't let the ambulance enter the park because of safety concerns. After the car and bus returned to the park, a ceasefire was ordered by a police commander. The CMU officers returned to their tactical operations center, marching in a box formation covered by the True Team members. Nicholas Cottrell, the teenage boy driving the bus, was transported to hospital by ambulance. It was believed he had a gunshot wound to the back, but it was later discovered that he had actually been hit by a piece of glass from a shattered bus window. He was treated and released from hospital within a few hours. Cecil Bernard George was transported to hospital by ambulance as well. He had multiple blunt force injuries to his head, face, arms, and stomach. He was treated and released from hospital the next day. Dudley George was the last to arrive at the hospital, driven there in a beat-up res car by his brother. Dudley's sister was also in the car, along with his 14-year-old cousin. The young cousin was in the back seat with Dudley and applied pressure to the gunshot wound in his left shoulder. On the way to the hospital, Dudley's brother Pierre was driving so fast he got a flat tire. But Pierre kept going, driving at full speed on the tire rim with sparks flying. When they arrived at the hospital, doctors attempted to resuscitate Dudley George, but he was pronounced dead shortly after arrival at 12:20 a.m. The next day, police issued a news release, which pointed the blame at the occupiers. They said they were called to the park after reports that armed protesters trashed a civilian car. Remember, it was really one person throwing a rock at a car as it drove away after a small altercation between a band counselor and protesters. Police went on to say they were peppered with rocks when they approached the park and that occupiers drove a bus and a car at them. They said the occupants from the vehicles opened fire on the officers, who defended themselves by returning fire. The official statement by police didn't mention the beating of Cecil Bernard George by officers. The occupiers maintained they had no weapons in the park, and they confronted police because they were trying to save Cecil Bernard George. Over the next few days, media and onlookers remained outside the park. Activists from reserves in London, Sarnia, and Brantford, Ontario, joined the original occupiers. And tensions remained extremely high. Protesters had no intention of backing down. The Grand Chief of Canada's Assembly of First Nations at the time was a soft-spoken man named Ovid Macready. He arrived at Iprawash after the shooting to act as a mediator and immediately called on Ontario's Premier Mike Harris to intervene in the standoff.
The fact of the matter is that there's rights involved here, and that the Premier of the province of Ontario has to get involved. Ultimately, the answer is with him as to whether or not there's a resolution to this dispute here. And he cannot carry on with the policy that Indian rights will be dealt with the barrel of the gun. That's not acceptable to us as Indian people.
Premier Mike Harris refused to get involved.
As I've said on several occasions since the provincial park was seized, and I repeat today, these matters are in the hands of the Ontario Provincial Police and the Special Investigations Unit.
Harris vowed he would not negotiate with the protesters until they ended their illegal occupation of Iprawash Provincial Park. On September 11, 1995, 5 days after Dudley George was shot to death, sacred fires were lit inside the former Iprawash military camp beside Iprawash Provincial Park. The occupation of the camp had begun 6 weeks earlier. Now, Dudley George was being laid to rest there, deep inside a forested area. Carloads and busloads of First Nations people came from many provinces and the United States to attend the funeral.
Once inside Camp Iprawash, the overflow waited outside the building where the service took place. Then they slowly marched down Army Camp Road to the Stony Point Cemetery, a decades-old resting place for the George family.
There's a burial ground back there that's been theirs, but also the park has been their traditional burial ground. And the older people have already know that, and they've already told us that.
This is to be a traditional Chippewa ceremony led by spiritual leaders from their community. Gord Peters, the regional vice chief for the Assembly of First Nations, says the ceremony will help Mr. George on his way to the spirit world.
The OPP stayed away from the funeral out of respect to the George family, and the only police on hand were Indigenous officers who displayed white flags on their squad cars. In July 1996, 10 months after the death of Dudley George, the officer involved, Acting Sergeant Ken Dean, was charged with criminal negligence causing death. The Special Investigations Unit, which investigates injuries and deaths caused by police, also looked into the beating of Cecil Bernard George. They interviewed about 50 police officers, but no one could or would identify which officers took part in the beating, so no charges were laid. When Acting Sergeant Ken Dean's trial began in April 1997, 100 people packed the courtroom for the Crown's opening statement, including 40 members of Dudley George's family. Some were wearing T-shirts with Dudley's picture on it, and some had buttons that read, "Remembering Dudley George." Others held eagle feathers. In his opening statement, Crown Attorney Ian Scott said that Dudley George was unarmed when he was shot. He said forensic testing found no gunpowder residue on his hands, and that in fact, none of the occupiers in the park were found to be armed. When Acting Sergeant Ken Dean took the stand, he maintained that Dudley George pointed a rifle at him, and that's why the officer opened fire with his submachine gun. Dean showed no emotion as he testified that George managed to throw his weapon across a roadway into a bushy area after he was shot. Reporter Peter Edwards covered the trial, and he says there is no way that George could have thrown a rifle the way that Dean testified in court.
To believe his version, Dudley George had to, who was 5'8 or 5'9, not a very big guy and not really that athletic, he had to throw away his gun and throw it so far that the police couldn't retrieve it, and also throw it when none of the police who had radios reported it. And so in a very close area, this guy would have had to have thrown his gun like a javelin when he's being fired upon after he'd been shot through his ribs and his collarbone and into the spine, and somehow thrown it so far that nobody could retrieve it, and somehow nobody bothered to comment on that on the radio. So like, it just didn't bear out with logic.
In closing arguments by the Crown and defense, they painted two totally different pictures of Acting Sergeant Ken Dean. The defense said that Dean was a conscientious officer protecting the OPP riot squad from an armed threat. The Crown, on the other hand, painted Dean as a rogue killer who took it upon himself to teach the occupiers some respect for police. Dean had opted out of a jury trial, so the decision was left up to one man. Justice Hugh Fraser would have to decide if Ken Dean knowingly shot an unarmed man. The day the verdict was read, the courtroom was packed with George's family and friends, along with police officers supporting Ken Dean. At the front of the room, the head of the OPP, Thomas O'Grady, sat right next to Ovid Macready, National Chief of the Assembly of First Nations. The judge ordered the doors be locked to prevent any interruptions and told spectators if they made any noise, they would be asked to leave. Then he read his judgment. He said, "I find that Dudley George did not have any firearms on his person when he was shot. I find that the accused, Kenneth Dean, knew that George was not armed, and the story of the rifle and the muzzle flashes was concocted after the fact in an ill-fated attempt to disguise the fact that an unarmed man had been shot." Judge Fraser finished by saying to Acting Sergeant Ken Dean, "I find, sir, that you were not honest in presenting your version of events to the OPP investigators and the SIU. You were not honest in maintaining the ruse before this court. I have considered all of the evidence presented in this case, and on the basis of the evidence that I have accepted, I find you, Kenneth Dean, guilty as charged." Reporter and author Peter Edwards was in the court when the judge handed down his verdict.
When you said, "I find you are not an honest man," it just went quiet for 3 or 4 seconds, and then there was a lot of crying. It was quite something, because there were a few seconds there where there was absolutely no noise whatsoever.
The silence was eventually broken when someone from George's group of family and friends let out a loud cheer. Then others began to sob. Ken Dean stared straight ahead and showed no emotion. When the judge read the decision on sentencing a month later, 6 young Indigenous men gathered outside the courthouse with drums to play a traditional song of remembrance. The rhythmic beating of their drums could be heard inside the packed courtroom as the sentencing was read. The maximum penalty that Dean could receive was life in prison. But at the time, there was no mandatory minimum sentence required for criminal negligence causing death. So, essentially, he could receive no jail time. Once again, that was up to the judge. Before handing down his sentence, Justice Hugh Fraser pointed out that Dean and other True Team officers had been incorrectly briefed that the activists occupying the park were armed with semi-automatic weapons. He went on to say the responsibility of the late-night tragedy could not be brought to rest solely on the shoulders of Ken Dean. Then Judge Fraser sentenced Dean to a conditional sentence of 2 years less a day to be served in the community, not behind bars. It took a couple of seconds for the sentence to sink in. Then Dudley's family and friends began to cry, and some shouted murderer, and some said he was a rotten cop. Outside the courthouse, Dudley supporters were in shock. They were angry, and they cried and hugged each other. But Dudley's sister Pam was still a little happy that the trial had cleared her brother's name. He wasn't the armed sniper that the OPP tried to paint him out to be. And Dudley's brother Sam said the comment by the judge that Dean was not solely responsible for the tragedy that night highlighted the need for a full public inquiry into what really happened at Ipperwash Provincial Park and why police were sent into the park in the first place. After the trial, Dean was relieved of operational duties and he was assigned to administrative work. He remained a police officer while the case worked its way through the appeals process. And then finally, in January 2002, after his final appeal was dismissed, Dean was forced to resign by a police tribunal. At the tribunal hearing, Dean apologized to the George family, and he said he would have done it sooner, but his lawyers had advised him not to. He said he didn't appear remorseful because he had internalized what happened, but he said he was indeed remorseful for what happened that night. He said, when you take a human life, it's a tragic incident, and he will carry it for the rest of his life. 5 years later, in 2006, Kenneth Dean was killed when his car was struck by a tractor trailer. He was 45 years old. In the years following the death of Dudley George, the Mike Harris government was continuously pressured to hold a full public inquiry to uncover what led up to the violent confrontation. The opposition at Queen's Park wanted to know if Mike Harris pressured the police to move into the park the night George was killed, and they believed an inquiry was the only way to get to the bottom of it. Plus, there were some rumors floating around that Premier Mike Harris had used some choice language during one of those meetings at Queen's Park. It was believed that he had said, "I want those effing natives out of the park."
In many ways, lingering questions about this man's death, Dudley George, continue to haunt the Conservative government. And today, another chapter. The George family has filed a wrongful death lawsuit naming former Premier Mike Harris and several senior Conservative ministers. The family has long alleged that the police faced political interference at the highest levels, interference that contributed to the death of George at Ipperwash Provincial Park.
Dudley's brother Sam was the point person for the George family on the wrongful death lawsuit. He was also tireless in his quest for a public inquiry. He spoke to church and labor groups, First Nations assemblies, students, teachers, human rights groups, and just about anyone else who would listen. He sometimes had to sleep in his car, which he nicknamed the Truthmobile, because he couldn't afford a hotel room. Even Amnesty International and the United Nations called for an inquiry. But Mike Harris, he wouldn't budge. He refused to hold hearings. Then in 2003, nearly 8 years since the events at Ipperwash, the Conservatives were voted out of power. And they were replaced by the Liberal Party, headed by Dalton McGuinty. And he quickly called a public inquiry into the death of Dudley George. The inquiry began in April 2004. It was held at a community center in the small town of Forest, Ontario, which wasn't too far from Ipperwash Provincial Park.
Seeking the truth is what the George family is determined to learn from this long-awaited inquiry. George's brother Sam told reporters he hopes to find out what really happened to his younger brother.
It's been a long
trail, a long process for us to get to this point, which is where we wanted to be 8.5 years ago. So now we're finally here, and we're going to go in and we're going to start to find out the truth of what really happened at Ipper Wash.
The head of the public inquiry, Commissioner Sidney Linden, warned that old wounds may be reopened during the process, but he went on to say it may also help the family heal and move on with their lives.
For the next 26 months, Justice Sidney Linden heard evidence from nearly 150 witnesses. Sam George sat in the front row throughout the entire two-year process, bearing witness for his brother Dudley. Sam and the rest of the public finally got to hear from some of the people involved in making decisions at Queen's Park, including several high-level bureaucrats who attended those emergency meetings held on September 5th and 6th, 1995. In November 2005, the Premier's aide, Deb Hutton, was called to testify at the inquiry. It was the first time the public would hear from someone within the Mike Harris inner circle. On the stand, Hutton denied telling the emergency meeting held the day after the occupation began that protesters should be evicted from the park as quickly as possible and that police should use guns if necessary. Hutton spent 2.5 days on the stand giving approximately 18 hours of testimony. But during that time, she was unable to shed much light on what took place or what was said, because she was unable to remember any comments by her boss, the Premier, on September 4th, 5th, and 6th about the occupation. Under cross-examination, the lawyer representing Aboriginal Legal Services said his staff tallied 134 times that Hutton testified that she couldn't recall things while on the witness stand. He sarcastically asked her if she had a medical condition or uses medication. The next major player to take the stand was former Attorney General Charles Harnick. On the first day, he testified that it was absolutely absurd to suggest he received instructions from the Premier to remove the protesters from the park within 24 hours. When Harnick took the stand the following Monday, he caught everyone, and I mean everyone, off guard when he dropped a major bombshell. He was asked about the meeting that occurred in the Premier's private dining room on the day that Dudley George was shot and killed. Harnick testified as he walked into the meeting, he heard something shocking.
Premier, in a loud voice, said, "I want the fucking Indians out of the park."
Harnick said he was stunned by the comment, and everyone in the dining room went quiet for a few seconds. Reporters and spectators at the inquiry were equally shocked by the testimony. Some reporters arrived late and they missed Harnick's testimony, and they couldn't believe he had actually thrown his former boss under the bus. Finally, in February 2006, 23 months after the inquiry began, former Premier Mike Harris took the stand. He was the 100th witness at the inquiry and possibly the most anticipated. He arrived at the inquiry surrounded by 6 plainclothes police officers and 4 of his lawyers. He squeezed through a crowd of over 50 members of the media and about 100 mostly Indigenous people who packed the public gallery. On the stand, Harris's voice was even and controlled, and his answers were direct. He denied ever telling his assistant, Deb Hutton, that he wanted the occupiers removed as soon as possible. But he conceded that she may have extrapolated that from his previous utterances. He calmly testified that he absolutely did not say, "I want the effing Indians out of the park," or any words to that effect. When asked if he would do anything differently if he could go back to September 1995, Harris replied, "I don't think so."
Sam George and his family have waited almost 12 years for this moment, through political battles at Queen's Park and a two-year, $20 million inquiry into the death of his brother Dudley from an OPP bullet.
At the end of May in 2007, the judge overseeing the inquiry released a 4-volume, 1,500-page report. About 200 people gathered at the community center where the inquiry took place to listen as Justice Linden revealed his conclusions.
The inquiry's key question: did Mike Harris and his government pressure the provincial police into a deadly confrontation with Native protesters occupying disputed land at Ipperwash Provincial Park?
The evidence does not support the claim that he interfered with the OPP's operation.
But Lyndon also found that Harris's push for a quick resolution cut off options for negotiation. And then there was the matter of the allegation that the premier said at a key meeting, get the effing Indians out of the park.
I have found that both the former premier and the Minister of Natural Resources made racist comments.
Harris, via his lawyer, was defiant.
Lyndon also said Iperwash revealed a deep schism in Canada's relationship with Indigenous people and was symbolic of a sad history of government policies that harmed their long-term interests. He said the inexcusable delay and long neglect by successive federal governments to deal with land claims are at the heart of the Iperwash story. Lyndon urged the federal government to return the former army camp to the Kettle and Stony Point people and compensate them for the delay in returning the land. He also urged the provincial government to create a Ministry of Indigenous Affairs and set up a treaty commission for Ontario, an independent and impartial agency to deal with land claims. The Premier of Ontario at the time of the report was still Dalton McGuinty. He quickly apologized for the death of Dudley George on behalf of the provincial government. And later that year, the Ontario government established a Ministry of Indigenous Affairs. But a treaty commission was never established. According to the Ministry of Indigenous Affairs, government and First Nation representatives were unable to agree on what a treaty commission should achieve. It took nearly another decade, but the land at Iperwash was finally returned to the Kettle and Stony Point First Nation in 2016. As part of the handover, the band was also given $95 million in compensation from the federal government. $20 million went directly to families and ancestors, while the rest will be used for future development of the land. But before that land is developed, it must undergo an environmental cleanup, which involves removing unexploded grenades. The cleanup is expected to take about 20 years to complete. In the meantime, people continue to live at Camp Iperwash. Here's Monica Virtue.
People are living in the original army barracks that were built in 1942. They're full of asbestos. I mean, I've been inside a number of them, and there's giant holes in the ceiling where rain just pours in. Some of them are beautifully decorated inside, but others are in very rough shape, like to the extent where I worry about people in the winter, that they're going to be safe. And I worry that because there's not clean drinking water, it's always in the back of my head that something bad might happen.
Among those living at the barracks is Dudley's brother, Pierre George. He helped to design a monument for Dudley, which was erected at the former Iperwash Provincial Park. Monica says he continues his fight to raise awareness about treaty issues. Dudley's brother Sam passed away from cancer in 2009, but before he did, he said this in an interview. We want Dudley to be the last person to die in a dispute over First Nations territories. Dudley has left to the spirit world, and we can only thank him for what he did for the First Nations people at Kettle and Stone Point. But one life lost is one too many, and one cannot put a price on a person's life, especially since all life is sacred. Thanks for joining me on this look back at the troubling story of the Iperwash crisis. And thanks to my guests, Monica Virtue and Peter Edwards, for helping us understand what happened and why. Their contact information will be in the show notes. If you have any show ideas, please let me know. I always love hearing from you about ideas or whatever's on your mind. You can reach me through Twitter at 1990s History. I'm also on Instagram and Facebook. And you can email me directly at 90s@curiouscast.ca. That's 90s@curiouscast.ca. If you haven't already, please make sure to subscribe to our show so you never miss an episode. And while you're there, feel free to rate and review us. You can find us for free at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and everywhere else you get your streaming audio. And you can also listen at curiouscast.ca. This show is hosted and co-written by me, Kathy Gonzora, and Dila Velasquez, our producer. Sound design and final production is by Rob Johnston. See you next time for more history of the 90s. Yeah. When I say Mike Tyson, what do you think of? A high-pitched lisping voice? A big face tattoo? Ear biting? Then again, maybe you know him from the Scooby-Doo-like cartoon called Mike Tyson Mysteries. Or maybe you immediately think of this.
Thanks again, champ. And, again, we are so sorry we stole your tiger.
Man, don't worry about it, man. Like you said, we all do dumb s*** and f***ed up.
Most likely, you think of Mike Tyson as a caricature of an out-of-control celebrity whose life has spiraled in so many different and strange directions that it's hard to keep up. As sports writer Bill Simmons put it, when celebrities allow their reputation to become so bizarre that any story about them is believable, these celebrities have entered the Tyson zone. But before all of this, Mike Tyson was a Goliath in the boxing world, a giant in sports throughout the 80s and the 90s, and also a convicted rapist. I'm Kathy Kinzora, and today on History of the 90s, we're looking back at Iron Mike, the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Boxing in the 1990s was at a peak. In fact, the 90s are considered the last great era of heavyweight boxing. Fighters like Evander Holyfield, Lennox Lewis, Riddick Bowe, and of course, Mike Tyson dominated the sport. Tyson was compared to all the greats. Some said he was even better. Stronger than Muhammad Ali, quicker than Rocky Marciano, and more polished than George Foreman. Even his opponents didn't want to beat him, they just wanted to survive. By the beginning of the 90s, Tyson, the baddest man on the planet, Kid Dynamite, Iron Mike, whatever you chose to call him, was on his way to becoming one of the greatest fighters of all time. He was undefeated after 37 fights. Let that sink in. 37 fights. And he'd been the heavyweight champion of the world for 4 years. He seemed, well, indestructible.
This guy was Vladimir Guerrero Jr., Jose Bautista, Austin Matthews, Donovan Bailey, Ben Johnson, all rolled into one, but with a violent edge, surly edge, really not a nice person, just a real mean guy who wanted to do destruction.
That's Mark Hebscher, the longtime sports broadcaster and host of the podcast Hebsy on Sports. Hebsy says Tyson was a train wreck just waiting to happen. And things started going off the rails in February 1990. That's when 23-year-old Mike Tyson squared off with Buster Douglas. When Tyson stepped into the ring and took... Tyson dropped in a heap to the floor. The referees stood over Tyson, who lay flat on his back, and they counted him out.
Unbelievable! Unbelievable! Buster Douglas is the new heavyweight champion of the world!
It was the biggest upset in boxing history. This is one of those moments from the 90s that people use as a sort of timestamp. Lots of us remember where we were when Douglas knocked out Tyson. It may have just been boxing, but it transcended sports and became news. When Tyson finally rolled over and pushed himself up, his mouthpiece hung from his teeth and he looked completely dazed. He managed to walk out of the ring, but then his corner men had to carry him the rest of the way. Reporters mobbed the dressing room, but they were told to get lost. 5 hours later, Tyson reemerged from the dressing room, along with promoter Don King and the rest of his entourage. Wearing wraparound sunglasses and a beige tracksuit, Tyson told reporters that he believed in his heart that he was still the heavyweight champion of the world. And he wasn't just saying that, he actually thought he should have won. Let me explain. Remember when Douglas went down at the end of the eighth round? Well, Team Tyson claimed that Douglas was down for more than 10 seconds, so they lodged a formal protest. But you see, in boxing, a 10 count doesn't mean an exact 10 seconds. It isn't timed like a 100-meter race. It's simply a referee count to 10, and long counts like this one happen in boxing all the time. So, not surprisingly, the protest didn't go anywhere. Douglas remained the champ, setting the stage for an epic rematch. So, what happened? How did Buster Douglas take down Iron Mike? Well, Mark Hepscher has a theory.
Oh, I know what happened in that fight. I mean, Buster's mother had died of cancer a few weeks before the fight. And there was talk that he wouldn't be able to fight, and he was just a man on a mission. And you know, Tyson was kind of lackadaisical. He was unbeaten. He probably took Douglas for granted, and Douglas had the fight of his life. Buster Douglas was never the same before or since.
Others also blame Tyson's flamboyant promoter, Don King, who had wiggled his way into Tyson's career and taken over just about everything, cutting out everyone who may have been able to keep the young boxer grounded. Let's take a minute here to look back at where Mike Tyson came from, how he ended up in the boxing ring in the first place. Well, Tyson was born in Brooklyn, New York in 1966. His father took off when Tyson was just 2 years old, leaving his mom to raise three kids in a tough, crime-ridden neighborhood. By 11 years old, Tyson was robbing stores and mugging people on the streets. He was arrested 38 times before he turned 13. But then his life took a pivotal turn. Tyson was sent to juvie in upstate New York, and one of the counselors there was a former professional boxer, and he ran a boxing program for troubled teens. Tyson begged to be part of the program, and when they finally let him in the ring, everyone was blown away by his natural talent. Eventually, the counselor running the program called in legendary boxing manager and trainer Cus D'Amato. He took Tyson under his wing, not just as a trainer, but as a surrogate father. After he was released, Tyson's mom died, so he moved in with D'Amato and his family in the Catskills. D'Amato became Tyson's legal guardian. D'Amato put Tyson on a rigorous training schedule with a goal of making the 1984 Olympic team. When that failed, it was time for Plan B. Tyson turned pro and almost immediately earned the nickname Iron Mike because of his strength and his ability to quickly knock out opponents. He won every single match he fought, throwing unbelievably hard punches. But Tyson's success was soon overshadowed by the death of Cus D'Amato in 1985. The man who made the young boxer would never see the champion he was about to become. In November 1986, at the age of 20, Tyson knocked out Trevor Burbick in 5 minutes and 35 seconds and became the youngest ever heavyweight champion. Guys from D'Amato's crew had taken over Tyson's career. Kevin Rooney was his trainer, Jim Jacobs and Bill Caton were his co-managers. But then, in yet another shock, Jim Jacobs died. Tyson was completely blindsided and devastated by yet another loss. And that's when Don King began to move in on the young fighter. At first, he was just Tyson's promoter, but he soon pushed out Caton and also became his manager, fully in charge of his career. At the same time, Tyson had gotten married to actress Robin Givens. You may remember the couple's high-profile relationship. It was tabloid fodder taken to the next level, thanks to an interview they did with Barbara Walters. During the televised interview, Givens accused Tyson of abuse and said her husband was a manic depressive. For his part, Tyson, a man who was a beast in the boxing ring, sat expressionless with his arm around Givens as she described the problems in their marriage.
He's got a side to him that's scary. Michael is intimidating, to say the least. I think that there's a time when he cannot control his temper, and that's frightening to me, or to my mother, and to anyone around.
Shortly after the interview, it came as no surprise when the couple announced that they were divorcing. And then with Tyson's personal life in shambles, Don King gained even more control. King fired trainer Kevin Rooney and forced Tyson to cut off ties with everyone from his past. And that's when things really started to change. Tyson's mental and physical strength began a downward spiral that would continue for years. That brings us back to where we started, the infamous fight against Buster Douglas. In the months that followed the 1990 upset against Buster Douglas, Tyson admitted he'd been taking shortcuts in his training and desperately wanted a rematch. Tyson went back in the ring in June 1990 to fight Henry Tillman. The boxer had a record of 20-4 and wasn't expected to be much of a challenge for Tyson. Just a way for Tyson to regain his confidence, really. And it worked. Tyson knocked out Tillman in 2 minutes and 47 seconds. After the fight, Tyson pronounced that he was still the best fighter in the universe. But he still wasn't the world champ, and either was Buster Douglas. Because after Douglas upset Tyson, he took on Evander Holyfield in a title match. Holyfield easily knocked out an overweight and out-of-shape Douglas in the third round. So Holyfield was now the man that Tyson needed to beat to get back his title. But an ongoing feud between King and Holyfield's promoter, Shelley Finkel, stopped the two sides from agreeing on getting in the ring. Finally, though, a fight between Tyson's years of probation. And despite being 25 years old at the time of the crime, he was assigned to the Indiana Youth Center. He was released in March 1995 after serving less than 3 years of his sentence. Once he was out of prison, Tyson was determined to make a comeback. In September 1996, he squared off in Vegas against Bruce Seldon for the WBA Heavyweight Championship. Tyson easily defeated Seldon in a first-round knockout. In fact, it happened so quick, 1 minute and 49 seconds, that the fans screamed fake. But there was bigger news happening that night. September 7th, 1996 was also the night that Tupac Shakur was fatally shot after attending the Tyson-Seldon fight at the MGM Grand Casino. Tupac and Tyson were close friends in the 90s, and Tupac even visited Tyson while he was in jail in 1992. 2 months later, on November 9th, 1996, Don King finally got Tyson the fight he'd been waiting for. He would defend his WBA championship against Evander Holyfield. Tyson, who was in financial troubles by now, would make $30 million for the fight. Holyfield, $11 million. Holyfield was the underdog heading into the fight. Vegas betting odds were 25-1 in favor of Tyson. People were actually worried that Holyfield might leave the ring on a stretcher. But man, were they wrong. Holyfield left Tyson dazed and bloodied.
Cut, not looking good. Above the left eye of Mike Tyson. So now a sense of
Holyfield delivered 15 straight punches to Tyson's head in the final seconds of the 10th round. Tyson wobbled out of his corner for the 11th round, gauze over his left eye. Within seconds, Holyfield had him trapped against the ropes. That's when the ref jumped in and called the fight. Tyson said he couldn't remember anything after the third round. He didn't know where he was or what he was doing. During the fight, Tyson had complained to the ref that Evander Holyfield had headbutted him, but the ref told him to keep fighting. When Tyson spoke to the media after the fight, he was still a bit dazed and surprisingly humble. He said, "Holyfield fought a good fight. I take my hat off to him. I look forward to a rematch." That's right, another rematch. Promoter Don King immediately began working on a rematch. He said, "Don't write Tyson off. We're going to dance again. We're going to see if we can put together the greatest rematch in the history of boxing." The rematch happened 6 months later. By now, Mike Tyson was 30 years old. He seemed more mature, almost mellow, and his priorities had changed. Tyson had 4 kids at this point and a 5th on the way. He said he was fighting now to build his kids a nest egg, to give them the childhood and the life he never had. They would get quite a nice nest egg from the rematch against Holyfield, set to take place in June 97. Again, Tyson would make $30 million for the fight. This time, Holyfield was getting $35 million. At the time, it was the largest single event payout in history. The Sound and the Fury, as the fight was called, became one of the most bizarre and infamous fights in boxing history.
Mike Tyson enters the ring 2 days short of his 31st birthday, with his very future as a top-line heavyweight on the line.
Even though he was defeated in the previous fight, Tyson went in the favorite, but just slightly. Vegas betting odds were 2-1 in his favor. But like the last time, after the first two rounds, Holyfield was easily winning. Tyson complained that Holyfield had headbutted him again in the second round. As the third round was about to begin, Tyson came out of his corner without his mouthpiece. The ref ordered him to put it in, and the fight resumed. Then near the end of the round, Tyson spit out his mouthpiece and bit a chunk out of Holyfield's right ear.
What happened here?
He got bit, I think.
Evander Holyfield, look out!
The ref penalized Tyson 2 points and allowed the fight to continue.
A very angry Evander Holyfield now.
You know, it's funny, Mike was having his best friend again.
Seconds after fighting resumed, Holyfield was stomping up and down, angry and in obvious discomfort. Many in the audience were unsure what had occurred, and they thought maybe Tyson had hit him low. When the ref approached Holyfield's corner, he discovered that Tyson had bitten Holyfield again, this time taking off the top of his ear. Tyson, this time, was immediately disqualified from the fight. Chaos erupted inside and outside the ring. Holyfield's corner man started screaming at Tyson, which triggered Tyson to charge Holyfield's corner. A police officer was knocked over in the mayhem.
Tyson's trying to get at Holyfield again, I believe. It is complete bedlam, and Tyson is just taking swipes at anybody in front of him.
Security guards pulled Tyson off, and then minutes later, Tyson stormed Holyfield's corner again.
He seems possessed right now.
When Tyson and his group finally left the ring, they were booed and pelted with hot dogs and beer by the crowd. Tyson and his handlers even made a brief attempt to jump into the stands, which caused another mini riot. The MGM Grand was even forced to close for several hours after the fight because of reported gunfire. Gamblers, fearing for their lives, jumped under blackjack tables and behind slot machines. Later, Tyson said he bit Holyfield in retaliation for several headbutts that cut him above the eye.
What am I to do? This is my career. I can't continue getting butted like that. I got children to raise, and this guy keeps butting me, trying to cut me and get me stopped on cut. I gotta retaliate.
2 days later, Tyson apologized for what he called the worst night of his career. He asked to be forgiven for snapping in the ring and doing something he never should have done. Holyfield accepted his apology. But it wasn't enough for boxing officials. The Nevada State Athletic Commission revoked Tyson's boxing license and fined him $3 million for the biting incident. But the ban wasn't permanent. Tyson was entitled to reapply after a year, and he did just that. A little over a year after the bite fight, Mike Tyson was allowed back in the ring. During his time away from boxing in 1998, Tyson was still out there. He made a guest appearance at WrestleMania 14 as an enforcer for the main event match between Shawn Michaels and Steve Austin, and he was paid $3 million. Sports broadcaster Mark Hebscher says no matter what, Tyson was never far from the spotlight in the 90s.
And in those days, too, there were so many of those types of programs Inside Edition and that type of thing, where every night they just, the news wheel just had, you know, what's up with Mike Tyson every single day. He was in the news every day for years. Anything he did, you know, getting gas, there's a picture of Mike Tyson.
As the decade came to a close, Tyson was in hot water again for assaulting two motorists following a traffic accident. On February 5th, 1999, Tyson was sentenced to another year in jail. He served 9 months of that sentence. This is where I'm going to end the story of Mike Tyson. But obviously, his story is far from over. It spanned decades beyond what we looked at in this podcast. He's a larger-than-life personality and has dabbled in movies, Broadway, and an animated kids show. His legal and financial issues continue, and he's been sued a bunch of times and declared bankruptcy. But in recent years, he's attempted to reinvent himself as a kinder, gentler version of Iron Mike. A Sports Illustrated feature a couple of years ago said the baddest man on the planet is now a suburban dad, wearing white New Balance shoes and dad jeans. He has 7 kids and is on his 3rd marriage. Today, he is founder of Tyson Ranch, a marijuana farm, and he hosts a podcast called Hotboxin' with Mike Tyson. If you've got an idea for a show, whether it's sports or whatever it is, I'd love to hear from you. Please drop me a line at 90s@curiouscast.ca. That's 90s@curiouscast.ca. You can also reach me through Twitter at 1990s History and on Instagram and Facebook. I love hearing from our listeners. Even if you don't have an episode suggestion, just reach out to say hi. I'd love to hear from you. We're available for free at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and everywhere else you get your streaming audio. You can also listen at curiouscast.ca. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. And while you're there, please don't forget to rate and review us. This episode was co-written by me, Kathy Canzora, and Dila Velasquez, our producer. Sound design and final production was by Rob Johnston. And thanks to Mark Hebscher for lending his voice. Make sure you check out his podcast, Hebsy on Sports. See you next time for more History of the 90s.
Hey, I'm Brett Chang.
And I'm Jay Rosenthal.
And we're here to tell you about Canada's only daily business news podcast.
It's called The Peak Daily, and every morning we get you up to speed on the need-to-know Canadian and global business news stories.
And we do it without all the jargon that can make business news a little dull. Dull, exactly.
And we do it all in less than 10 minutes.
6 minutes if we fast-forward through your dad jokes.
But I prefer to call them rad jokes.
Come for the news, stay for the dad jokes. Join us and thousands of Peak Pals every morning to start your day smarter. Find The Peak Daily wherever you listen to your podcasts.
When someone suggested that Nickelodeon should create a game show for its young viewers, network executives gathered a bunch of staffers in an office for a brainstorming session. Everyone was invited, from secretaries to writers. No one was considered more important. All ideas were on the table. The only rules for the show: make it so kids could play along at home, and make sure there was something at stake so young viewers would care about what they were watching. In the meeting, someone threw out the idea of making the show like the board game Mousetrap, but instead of a ball, it would be a person. From there, the hugely popular game show Double Dare was born, and a revolution in TV programming for kids was set in motion. I'm Kathy Canzora, and this is History of the 90s, a podcast about a decade that changed the world. On today's episode, Nickelodeon's Golden Age. Nickelodeon was the first cable channel dedicated entirely to kids. But prior to being known for green slime and orange splats, the network was more about education than fun. Before we talk about Nickelodeon's Golden Age, an era that roughly spans from 1983 to 1995, let's go back to the very beginning. The genesis for Nickelodeon occurred in December 1977, when Warner Cable launched a show called Pinwheel on an experimental cable system in Columbus, Ohio. Pinwheel was the brainchild of Dr. Vivian Horner, who'd been the director of research for the classic PBS kids series, The Electra Company. Essentially, Pinwheel was a Sesame Street knockoff. Lots of puppets, a few humans, and a catchy theme song. Aired for 5 hours a day on the commercial-free kids' educational channel, which was also called Pinwheel. And the concept was successful enough that 2 years later, in April 1979, it expanded nationwide and was rebranded as Nickelodeon. According to Matthew Klickstein, author of Slimed, An Oral History of Nickelodeon's Golden Age, the early Nickelodeon was considered a loss leader for then-parent company Warner Cable.
Because they were basically using it to try to attract families into getting their fuller package, Warner's was with Movie Channel, and that started to grow as well, they didn't really care about the programming on the channel. In fact, they were making it more specifically to get awards and to get praise from people like Peggy Charon, who ran an agency that would dealt with parents watching TV and kind of determining what was good for kids or not. So they made it very purposely educational and purposely kind of speaking down to the children. They were really creating it as something that they could pitch as this award-winning educational channel that the families would like, but that kids maybe weren't that interested in because they didn't really care. They just wanted kind of that gloss on it. So there were all these early shows that kind of came and went and that nobody's really heard of.
Some of those early shows included Columbus Goes Bananas, which eventually became America Goes Bananas, Stand By, Lights, Camera, Action, a movie show hosted by Leonard Nimoy, aka Spock, on Star Trek, and a show about roller coasters called Wild Ride, starring a young, up-and-coming 80s movie star.
Hi, I'm Matt Dillon, and I really dig roller coasters. I can still remember my first ride. I guess I was 6 or 7. I was on the Dragon Coaster at Playland in Rutgers, New York.
Matthew Klickstein says in the early days, the channel was pretty desperate for content. So there were also a lot of weird animated shows licensed cheaply from Eastern Europe. In 1982, still on the hunt for affordable content, Nickelodeon picked up a Canadian show that had already been airing on Ottawa's CJOH TV for a couple of years.
Jaws Eats. Jacques Cousteau will not be shown at this time in order that we may bring you the following special program devoted to bathroom humor.
Hey, Moose.
Yeah, Ren?
Do you want to buy a very rare television set?
What's so rare about it?
This set used to belong to Sir John A. Macdonald.
Oh, right. They didn't even have television in those days.
That's what makes it so rare.
You Can't Do That on Television was a low-budget variety show with comedy skits featuring mostly kids, music videos, and live call-in contests for viewers. Initially, when Nickelodeon picked up the show, they simply aired repackaged reruns. But they soon discovered their young viewers loved it. So the network decided to partner up with CJOH to make new episodes that took the show up several notches. That meant no more disco dancers or performances by aging Canadian rock bands like Trooper and Max Webster. But they did keep something from the original show, something that would become synonymous with Nickelodeon.
But, Alistair, what else could there be in that green stuff?
Well, I don't know. See, that's why I'm confused.
If you're not familiar with You Can't Do That on Television, every time someone on the show said, I don't know, they got slimed, which means a bunch of chunky green liquid would fall from above, splashing over their head, face, and body. In the scene you just heard, Canadian actor Alistair Gillis was trying to use science to figure out what slime was made of. Not sure if he ever got there, but I can tell you now that slime was made of gelatin powder, oatmeal, and water, with some baby shampoo added to the mix to make it wash out of hair better, which was pretty thoughtful, I guess. Despite being paid an extra $150 every time they got slimed, cast members apparently hated it, especially the show's popular kid host, Christine Moose McGlade. Although unpopular with the cast, the viewers loved it. So much that in 1984, Nickelodeon held its first slime-in contest. The winner got a trip to the set of You Can't Do That on Television to get slimed, of course.
All you gotta do is watch new episodes of You Can't Do That on Television all next week and say hello to the future of slime. When you see the slime in a dress, send in a postcard and you can win a chance to say, you know, be a part of slime history.
And yes, I must mention that one of Canada's favorite alt-rockers from the 90s, Alanis Morissette, appeared in 5 episodes of You Can't Do That on Television in 1986, when she was just 12 years old. Long before she was screaming you ought to know to a hated ex-boyfriend, Alanis was trying to avoid getting slimed. Thanks to that green goo and the funny kid-friendly skits and gross-out jokes, You Can't Do That on Television was a big hit for Nickelodeon. But the network's ratings overall were still pretty dismal, and they were losing money. If Nickelodeon was going to stick around, it was make or break time. And thanks to a visionary new leader, the network would not only stick around, it would embark on a golden age of programming. In 1983, Nickelodeon, heavily in debt, began to take corporate underwriting. Shortly after, the network bit the bullet and accepted advertising. Nickelodeon also began to shed its earlier image as a parent-approved channel. When Geraldine Laybourne took over, everything changed. Forget the boring educational shows that won awards and the praise of parents. What is now called the green vegetable era was over. It was time for dessert. Laybourne wanted shows that kids would like. Shows that wouldn't talk down to them or teach them anything. She just wanted stuff that was fun. So Laybourne started building a team that had the same vision.
And they were actually, I don't want to say anti-education, but a lot of them told me that, you know, look, if kids want to get educated, or families want to get the kids educated, there was PBS. Or there was, you know, certain movies or Sesame Street or Electric Company or whatnot. It's like, they wanted to stand out. It's like, no, this is where you can rest, relax, have fun, get messy, you know, be silly. They really wanted to be, you know, not necessarily anti-education, but just not education. They want to just be fun. And so that also was a big deal, though, because not only do kids love that kind of stuff anyway, but it helped them in the market to really stand out. We're not PBS. We're not, you know, Sesame Street. We're not Mr. Rogers. We are Nickelodeon. And that really helped them also with their brand. And that was important, too.
It seems kind of obvious, but Jerry Laybourne and her team also started talking to kids about what they wanted to watch. It was the first time that focus groups involving kids were held about TV programming.
Whether it was the early Mickey Mouse Club or Captain Kangaroo or Bozo the Clown or even things like Sesame Street or Mr. Rogers, it was either, you know, just adults in the room who were figuring out what are kids going to want, what are kids going to like, advertisers, educational experts, but nobody was really talking to the children and seeing what the kids wanted. And there's a very good reason for that, because it wasn't until the 80s that you started having more latchkey kids and you had kids who were watching TV by themselves and had control over the remote.
Behind the scenes, some other changes were happening. Warner had spun off MTV and Nickelodeon into a newly formed subsidiary called MTV Networks. And a rebranding of the kids' channel to match its new anti-adult image began. The original logo showed a man in a bowler hat looking into a coin-operated movie machine called a Nickelodeon. But seriously, unless you were alive in 1910, how would you even know what that was? Anyway, the logo was updated a couple years later with rainbow letters over a silver pinball. Then, in 1984, the guys responsible for MTV's rock and roll branding were put in charge of updating Nickelodeon's look. And what they came up with was this catchy jingle and the iconic orange splat logo that could morph into anything. A foot, a cloud, a dinosaur, or a lightning bolt. Nickelodeon. A year later, in 1985, Nickelodeon launched a new nighttime programming block called Nick at Night. Starting at 8 p.m., the channel ran a succession of vintage 60s sitcoms from Donna Reed to Mr. Ed that lured baby boomers and their kids to the channel. Many kids who grew up in this era have some pretty special memories of watching old black and white programs like I Love Lucy, Dick Van Dyke, and The Andy Griffith Show with Mom or Dad before bed. That same year, entertainment conglomerate Viacom purchased MTV Networks from Warner. And under Viacom, the network started focusing more on making money and investing in original programming instead of just repurposing old shows and licensing existing characters. What followed over the next 10 years was an explosion of innovative, fun, kid-focused programs in every category: cartoons, live action, variety, and game shows. I'm going to take a look at each of those types of programs, but let's start first with game shows. When Nickelodeon started making original programming, budgets were still pretty tight. A game show, which would be cheap and easy to produce, seemed like the obvious place to start. The first show they came up with was an instant hit.
On your mark, get set, go!
The first of these two teams to make a mummy out of their partner with a roll of toilet paper will win $20 and control of the most daringly different show on television. Double Dare!
Double Dare, which was credited with putting the network on the map, pitted teams of kids against each other in a series of trivia questions and wacky physical challenges, all in an effort to make it to a sloppy obstacle course finale. Focus groups had told Nickelodeon and executives that kids lived vicariously through their parents, watching Price is Right and Wheel of Fortune, because they didn't have a game show of their own. So Nickelodeon set out to create a version with kids in mind. On Double Dare, teams that made it to the obstacle course at the end had to complete 8 rapid-fire physical challenges. Everything from pulling a flag out of a giant nose covered in green slime boogers to running through the 1-ton human hamster wheel. It was TV magic. Here's Matthew Footstein.
You are hardwiring fun and entertainment into an entire generation of kids. And that is obviously, I mean, I'll even admit, I was one of probably many who, I didn't really watch the, the trivia aspect. I would kind of wait, I'd sort of flip around until the obstacle course came on, because that was what I really watched Double Dare for. And I know a lot of other people did the same thing.
Other physical challenges involving food were also hugely popular with viewers. Who couldn't resist seeing someone get chocolate syrup or orange juice dumped on their head? Food was such a big part of Double Dare that in 1987, the New York Times asked a show staffer to calculate the amount of food used during a typical taping. According to their tally, 50 gallons of whipped cream, 30 gallons of slime, dozens of eggs, and 100 cubic feet of popcorn were used. To offset concerns over food waste, production used as much past-dated canned material or other expired goods as possible, which apparently made things kind of smelly on set. Matthew Klickstein says it wasn't just the slimy gack and ridiculous stunts that appealed to kids who watched Double Dare. He says host Mark Summers was also a big part of the show's success.
He was such a perfect host and such a perfect kind of identity for Nickelodeon at the time. He wasn't too old, but he wasn't too young. So there was this nice kind of, seemed sort of like an older brother, very avuncular, if anything else.
The original show ran from 1986 to 1993 and taped more than 500 episodes. It was so popular that there were spin-off shows like Family Double Dare and Super Sloppy Double Dare. Nickelodeon also partnered with Mattel to release a number of tie-in products, including a board game and the quintessential 90s toy called Yak, which was basically slime in a splat-shaped container. Ironically, crew members on the show were the first to come up with the name Yak for the obstacle course slime, and although the word is also slang for heroin, neither Nickelodeon or Mattel seemed to mind. Other Nickelodeon toys released in the 90s included a Gak Vac and a Gak Inflator. But believe it or not, Nickelodeon and executive Jerry Laybourne didn't want Double Dare or the network to be a total sellout. Legend has it, Nickelodeon turned down a $1 million offer by Casio to be the official time clock of the show. And according to Mark Summers, the network also refused a $1 million license deal to make Double Dare cereal. Summers regularly took the show on the road, including a 100-city live tour in 1993, where he drew thousands of fans of all ages who dreamed of having their face dunked in a giant bowl of whipped cream for a chance to win a Double Dare t-shirt. Double Dare was undoubtedly the most popular game show on Nickelodeon back in the day, but there were many other memorable shows that pitted kids against each other in a variety of wacky and fun ways, including Nick Arcade, Wild and Crazy Kids, Guts, and Legends of the Hidden Temple. Participating in a Nickelodeon game show, or at least being in the audience, was a dream for a whole generation of kids who, if lucky enough, made a family trip to Orlando to visit Nickelodeon Studios at Universal Studios. Beginning in 1990, the Orlando Studios were the epicenter for the network, which had previously been located in New York. Orlando was where many game shows, including Double Dare and other programs like the sitcom Clarissa Explains It All and the hugely popular variety show All That were filmed in front of a live studio audience. There were also behind-the-scenes tours of the huge complex, which was a pretty mind-blowing experience for kids who spent much of their free time watching Nickelodeon. You see, by 1990, Nickelodeon was being watched in 52 million households across the U.S. To put that in perspective, more kids were watching children's shows on Nickelodeon than all other three major networks combined. And many of the Nickelodeon shows were shown on networks around the world, including Canada's YTV. Chris Morgan, author of the book The Nickelodeon 90s, was one of those kids tuning into Nickelodeon.
I watched so much TV when I was a kid. I would in the summers trying to stay up all night surreptitiously in my bedroom watching TV, watching Nick at Night, watching old Nick, you know, classic sitcoms. And yeah, just sometimes I wonder how I had like the time. Like I think like I went to school, I played like hockey, I hung out with friends of mine. I was outside. I remember being outside a whole bunch, but I also remember watching so much TV. And I just like it feel like. I feel like the days must have been like 40 hours back then or something. It couldn't have possibly been only 24 hours. I feel like the 90s was like the maybe the best time to grow up as a TV lover because there was more options than there had been in previous generations because of cable. And there was still, you know, not the stress and fretting about, you know, how much time your kid's watching TV. And also because of Nickelodeon, which was the quintessential network for children in the 90s. And was like so influential, and like, you know, it's not gonna probably be like that ever again for any generation.
A New York Times article in October 1990 described Nickelodeon's climb to the top this way. What began as an earnest, all but invisible non-commercial network 11 years ago has evolved into a kid's icon with a sassy voice and an attitude that is just as distinctive as the one that made MTV such a hit. I mentioned that the variety show All That was filmed in front of a live audience at Nickelodeon Studios. Well, this show was hugely popular. It was a sketch comedy program, which was essentially a kids' version of Saturday Night Live, and it ran for an impressive 10 seasons, beginning in April 1994. It was created by Brian Robbins and Mike Tolan and spawned a number of spin-offs, including Good Burger, Kenan and Kel, and The Amanda Show. It also launched the careers of Kenan Thompson, Amanda Bynes, and Nick Cannon. Unfortunately, All That is also connected to the now-disgraced producer, Dan Schneider, who was head writer and showrunner. But that aside, the show is remembered for hilarious skits like Ask Ashley, Repairman, and The Loud Librarian.
Excuse me, can you please keep it down a bit?
Quiet! This is a library!
But you're the one making all the noise!
It's also remembered, though, for its diversity. The original cast included 4 girls and 3 boys. 3 of the performers were white, while 4 were of color. All That's producers knew its audience would be diverse, too, and they embraced that fact wholeheartedly. The opening credits were scored with an original song by TLC, and weekly musical guests were a diverse mix of pop, alternative, R&B, and hip-hop acts, including Aaliyah, Coolio, Erykah Badu, Missy Elliott, Bare Naked Ladies, and NSYNC. So we know that game shows and variety shows were a big hit on the network. But there were also some very popular scripted live-action shows on Nickelodeon. The first one was launched in July 1989.
Hey, dude. It's a little wild and a little strange when you make your home out on the range.
Hey, Dude followed the owner of an Arizona dude ranch and the teens who worked there for the summer. The show ran for 65 episodes over 2 years and was split up into 5 seasons. And even though it was a pretty low-budget and goofy show, it was loved by many and basically helped define Nick's programming for the next 25 years. It also launched the careers of 2 90s teen semi-stars, Christine Taylor, who played bubbly girl next door Melody Hansen, and David Lasher, who portrayed lovable troublemaker Ted McGriff. Christine Taylor went on to star as Marsha in the Brady Bunch reboot films and marry Ben Stiller, while David Lasher went on to play Josh on Sabrina the Teenage Witch. In recent years, Hey Dude has become a cult classic, not just for kids who grew up on the show, but also for new fans thanks to reruns, DVDs, and of course, the internet. Another favorite from that era made history by being the first Nick show with a female lead. Clarissa Explains It All, starring Melissa Joan Hart, debuted in March 1991. and would go on to become one of the biggest hits for the network. It was equally popular among boys and girls, which defied industry beliefs at the time that a show starring a female lead could not attract male viewers. Created by Mitchell Kriegman, who previously worked on both Saturday Night Live and Sesame Street, it was about a strong, quirky, and precocious young girl named Clarissa Darling, who had a pet alligator and a best friend named Sam, who used a ladder to climb through her bedroom window when he popped by for a visit. And like its main character, the show also did things differently. Clarissa would often break the fourth wall and talk directly to the audience and explain the storylines with fake news segments, graphics, and video games. Clarissa was also a bit of a 90s fashion icon, thanks to costume designer Lisa Lederer, who favored mismatched patterns and bold colors for an eclectic look that was soon imitated by teen girls who watched the show. In 2014, Melissa Joan Hart told Elle magazine that she saved every single piece that she wore on that show and has them stashed away in a basement closet. As for Clarissa's bedroom, where much of the show took place, initially it was done in all pink and was very frilly. But Kriegman says he had the set designers literally take black car paint and make checkered walls on top of the pink wallpaper. Clarissa explains it all initially aired on Sunday nights, but in 1992, it moved to the Saturday night primetime block on Nickelodeon called SNICK, which ran from 8 to 10 p.m. and included another popular show called Are You Afraid of the Dark? For 90s kids, the anthology series is remembered as one of the scariest shows of all time. Are You Afraid of the Dark focused on a group of young friends called the Midnight Society who told each other ghost stories. The show had plenty of now-famous guest stars, including Ryan Gosling. As for Clarissa Explains It All, it ended its run in 1994 after 65 episodes over five seasons. But it wasn't canceled because of bad ratings. Nickelodeon just decided that Clarissa was too old, which Kriegman says was very unfair. He thought the show could have grown up with her. After it was canceled, Kriegman pitched a new series to CBS called Clarissa Now, which followed the character to New York City after she got an internship with a newspaper. A pilot was shot in 1995, but the show wasn't picked up. The next year, Melissa Joan Hart moved on from Clarissa to become another 90s icon, Sabrina the Teenage Witch. Meanwhile, Kriegman never gave up on Clarissa. In 2015, he released a novel called Things I Can't Explain, which serves as a sequel to the series. The book follows Clarissa in her late 20s, navigating life as an adult. In 2018, rumors started to circulate that Nickelodeon was working on rebooting the show with Melissa Joan Hart returning to the iconic role. But Hart recently told Us Weekly the reboot is on hold. Now, the show that's considered one of the best, if not the best show ever made on Nickelodeon, wasn't the highest rated or the longest running, but it was probably the coolest. The Adventures of Pete and Pete ran for three seasons beginning in 1993. It actually started as a series of short vignettes that aired between shows on Nickelodeon 4 years earlier in 1989. It was so popular that five half-hour specials were made, and then finally a regular half-hour series. The concept was the idea of two guys who worked in the network's promo department, Will McRobb and Chris Viscardi. Together with Catherine Diekman, who had just directed a video for REM, they created a show that entertained kids with an undeniable 80s New York punk rock ethos. Viscardi has said that they didn't consciously try to bring a punk rock mindset to a kid's show. It was just what they were into at the time, so it seemed right. Matthew Klickstein says in the early days when Nickelodeon was located in New York, many of the young staffers were influenced by the art and music of the city.
The people who were making Nickelodeon were working on Nickelodeon by day, and at night they were going to all these different avant-garde theater shows and art shows and independent movie screenings, and they were part of it. They were there when it was happening. And so obviously that's going to trickle into what they're doing for Nickelodeon. A lot of them told me that they were intentionally trying to, you know, proselytize or convert kids into not just the mess and silliness and the reverence, but a little bit of a punk rock ethos.
The Adventures of Pete and Pete was not your typical kids show. First of all, what kids show features an 8-year-old with a tattoo of a topless mermaid named Petunia? The show also featured a string of super cool guest stars, including Michael Stipe from REM as Captain Scrummy and Iggy Pop as Pop Mecklenburg. The music also helped the show develop a cult following with the older crowd as well. The show featured music from indie icons like the Magnetic Fields and the Goth Archies, as well as Polaris, which was responsible for the show's popular theme song, Hey Sandy,